Greetings, humans. You have entered the Command Zone, your destination for all aspects of Elder Dragon Highlander. Enjoy your stay.
Hey guys, how's it going? Welcome back to another episode of The Command Zone, your number one place for commander-based news and information. I'm Jimmy Wong.
How's it? It's Josh.
And this is Craig Blanchette.
Craig has been on our show before. This is your second incarnation.
Is it better the second time around?
It always is, Jim.
Excellent. That's what I wanted to hear.
And Craig, you've got something very exciting in the works. Tell us a little bit about Game Cove.
Yeah, we've been working on a couple cool new things. We just finished up with the production of Top Decking Season 2, which you can check out at webisodesnetwork.com or at YouTube/webisodesnetwork. And we're working on a new site that's dedicated to high-quality gaming videos. We've got a couple big names on there.
Basically, it's going to be sort of a congregation of all of the content that you have trouble finding online. I mean, it's tough to get to one. Like, I go to like four different websites for Magic-based content, and it's kind of a hassle, to be honest. And Game Cove, I think, is going to provide an alternative that is easily accessible, has its own player. It's sort of like an offsite YouTube where you don't have to go sift through all the other stuff. You just have aggregated content that we know is quality and is presented to you in a way that's easy to digest and also easy to have access to all of it.
Yeah, it's basically like a curator. So it's going to be a place where you can go.
Yeah.
It's by gamers, for gamers, and it's going to do all the sifting that you would normally have to do. Like, you're not going to have to Google or go to your favorite five or six websites and find the newest article on the best thing or the whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, it's going to have the videos that it knows that you're going to like, and you know you're going to be able to trust it as a source, right?
Yeah,
exactly. If you're looking for the standard deck to build, or you know, anything Magic related or other TCG and gaming related, we will have it on Game Cove.
Yeah.
The great thing about Game Cove too is you guys are going to be like monitoring the content, so that you know I don't have to go through all this crappy, badly produced stuff to find the good stuff, right?
Exactly. We are focusing a lot on making sure that the content is easy to access and making sure that the user experience is as high as possible. So we're making sure that there's going to be a couple new features that people haven't seen before, and you know, a couple ways to make things a little bit more interesting with this new opportunity.
I dig it. I think anything that spices up the internet in a way that makes it easier for a consumer or someone that's using the internet to digest is really nice. YouTube's done a great job of that. And so did Twitter, you know, when you first started. But at a certain point, you sort of get overwhelmed by the options, right? And sometimes you just need a little focus. You know, I have separate Twitter accounts, to be honest, where I only follow things that I'm really interested in, or employees, fellow employees, or people, or friends of mine, just because I have too many other people I'm following on the main account. So it's nice that there's a place that hopefully we'll be able to focus this. And Game Cove is going to be that, I think.
Yeah, I think it's something that we've really needed, is just like a really an easier way to find stuff. It's just hard to find the stuff that I want to find. It just takes so long to find it that sometimes by the time I find it, I don't actually have time to watch it.
Sounds about right.
So, yeah. Okay, Jimmy, so what are we talking about today?
So today we are delving into the wonderful world of Khans of Tarkir. And
so excited.
It's like a set that was built for Commander.
Oh man.
Tricolors.
It looks so awesome.
Fetchlands.
Fetchlands.
Oh my god. It's like it was built for every format, which is awesome. I love what Magic's doing recently with everything that's going on.
Seriously, because when I look through it, I'm like, sweet, I'm gonna put that in my Commander deck. Oh man, I can't wait to draft it. Holy crap, I'm actually kind of getting excited about playing Standard.
Right.
Yeah, right.
What? I mean, I for the first time ever built a Standard deck, and I'm thrilled to be playing it. So I never play red or blue, but like red is not my spirit color. I'm not Jimmy. So
that's right.
You know,
for me to be
playing a red blue standard deck, which is like artifacts, like I'm all about like Gave and like Graveyard Recursion and you know, black
green black.
And
that means they got you.
They got me.
They got you
big time. And it's awesome.
I'm going to call it right now. This will be the best selling Magic set of all time.
Of all time.
I think so too.
Up till now, they might come up. They might trump it eventually, but this is going to be, it's crazy.
I just don't think you can beat the flavor.
It's awesome.
They built this huge world, and they're like, we have three sets to exploit it and have fun with it in all these different formats. It's great.
It's awesome. So before we get into cons, though, we want to talk about some changes that happened in the EDH world with the unbanning a few cards.
Yes.
So the way that the EDH ban list used to work is there was a few cards that were banned, but only as commanders. So you could still put them into your deck. You just couldn't have them be the general of your deck. Those cards were Kokusho, Raphelos, Arayo, Metalworker. Oh,
no, not Metalworker.
Metalworker's never. Sorry,
he's not legendary enough.
Right, Metalworker was just plain banned, and then Braids. was banned, but only as your commander. So those other four, not Metalworker, were banned as your commander. So what they decided to do is they decided to just either ban them all together or not have them be banned. So the three cards that are totally banned, you can't have them in your deck and you can't have them as your general, are Raphelos, Areo, and Braids.
Let's take a second to read what they all do so okay. We can understand why. Braids, Cabal Minion, is 4 mana cost, 2 and 2 black, 2/2. At the beginning of each player's upkeep, that player sacrifices an artifact, creature, or a land. All right. That is the worst commander to go against.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
I feel like this is not a huge deal because there's just a lot of cards in Magic that do this. Mm-hmm. I mean, the Abyss does it. There's just Smokestack. Like, there's a ton of cards that replace this effect. So this doesn't feel like a huge deal to me.
Yeah. Just play.
The only thing I think Children. That made this different was that you could have it as your commander, so you could rely on it that much more. And relying on a, I think they want to make this, I think, more fun. Not, you know, this commander is just not fun.
Right. Yeah.
You know, it's definitely a spiky card. I mean, you can take advantage of it, just like the Stacks deck. But
Yeah, well, Braids was actually banned as your commander for a while now, so you couldn't even do that. So to me, like, yeah, if it had been commander playable as your general, then I agree, but it hasn't for a while, so it's just acted as another card in your deck, and so I just feel like if you were playing Braids, don't worry, you can find a replacement that's going to do
it's
most
called
of what
Shieldred,
she does.
Pretty much, and it's better. Yeah. Right. I think it's the low mana cost that definitely hurt it.
So the next one is Areo, and just to make it really simple, she's a flip card. If you meet the requirement, you flip her, and then she becomes a legendary enchantment, and she counters the first spell cast every turn. So
yeah, by an opponent.
Yeah, now that is... that's what you're saying. That makes the game super unfun. It slows it down. I think really, like, that's powerful, but I think it's just banned in the vein of, like, that's not fun.
Exactly, which I think, you know, since they went through this change to make it either just purely banned or purely unbanned, which I think was a smart move on their part, since there was such a small list of ones that just couldn't be your commander, it didn't really make much sense.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, these, you know, decisions are definitely to keep the game more fun, which I approve of.
Yeah, I mean, it is kind of restrictive in not a very entertaining way either. It's just sort of this, like, weird world effect. The last one that was banned as a commander and now is just completely banned is Raphelos, Llanowar Emissary. It's 2 green mana total, just 2 green-green, just green-green. And it just taps to add 1 green mana to your mana pool for each forest you own. So that's pretty... It's just Ramp City. I'm glad that you can't play it in regular play too, because it's the effect that it has is so big compared to a lot of other greens ramp spells that it's uncatchable by other colors.
I think Raphelos was specifically banned. I may be wrong, but I think because it allowed Tooth and Nail on turn three.
Right.
And Tooth and Nail in Commander is often just win.
Yep.
So just get 2 cards that create an infinite combo, which you can do. So I think that's the problem with Raphelos, is that it just created a lot of, like, turn 3 or 4 win.
Yeah.
Which, you know, it's another way that the game's not fun.
Yeah, exactly. So, and there are ways to get to, like, a turn 4 win already, but Raphelos, I think, is just too easy of a combination.
Yeah, I think there are other cards that do that, but they're not as consistent. And Raphelos, you know, even if it's not your commander, that green has so many ways to search out a creature that you can get Raphelos out on turn 2 or turn 3, like, pretty consistently.
Reliably,
and then, you know, on turn 4, Tooth and Nail and just win. So that doesn't seem, I mean, I get that one.
I do just want to say he was my darling child in Omnath. My God.
Craig.
Sorry, man.
Lost a little bit of value there. One card that was unbanned entirely is Kokusho the Evening Star, 4 and 2 black, 6 mana total. Flying, but the big one is when Kokusho the Evening Star dies, each opponent loses 5 life, and you gain life equal to the life lost this way.
Which is
pretty interesting.
Yeah, it's interesting. I think when Kokusho was banned, he was a lot more powerful than he is now. There's a lot of cards that do stuff like this now, like hit everybody. Like, there's ways with Kokusho to sort of kill everyone all at once, but there's just a lot of cards that do that.
Yeah, exactly. You could draw them out with Nekusar.
There's ways to stop what Kokusho's trying to do, because you have to sack him or get him killed, reanimate him, do it again.
And he's going
to
cost 2 more each time.
Initially, too, when they created him, first of all, he creates such a gap. I mean, you gain 5 life for each player that's involved. So there was that.
Yeah.
But now there's a few other ways to die that have been introduced, like Infect, since that card was printed. There might be a few others. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe there's only one.
Was it, in fact, after Kamigawa?
Yes.
Oh.
So
I mean, they had, like, poison cards,
of course,
but they didn't have the proliferation like now. Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah.
And, you know, just that many more... The gain of life, the life disparity that happened there was not as big of an issue as it was before, because now there's a couple other ways they can die. Also, you know, there's recursion
Commander
and everything.
Damage,
yeah,
exactly.
You know. Yeah, I just think Kokusha, when you look at him now, it's just like, yeah, it's fine. Doesn't seem broken in any way.
Right.
Yeah. It's a card that it's like, okay, I'm not as extremely worried about this as I could have been.
It's just like still banned from ancient times.
And there's like two card infinite combos out there. Mm-hmm. And this is, you know, this relies on a few things. You need a sac outlet, you need a recursion outlet, you need Kokusho.
Makes him a fun commander to build around, I think. I think you could definitely make a really fun deck out of that. Mono black, of course. And the last card that was unbanned that I think is going to be drawing the most controversy
is
Metalworker, which is a 3-mana artifact creature. And you tap him to reveal any number of artifact cards in your hand, add 2 colorless mana to your mana pool for each card revealed this way.
Yeah, I don't get this one because it's so similar to Rofellos. So it's like, if you're going to make the statement that like early mana shenanigans are a problem, then Metalworker creates the same problem. I mean, I can play Tooth and Nail on turn 3. Well, with Metalworker, I can play Ulamog on turn 4. Like, is there a big difference there? I don't know.
I mean, maybe if you don't fetch an infinite combo, then sure, but...
I guess you can't get 2 cards.
Yeah.
Maybe it's not quite as powerful as Rofellos, but I mean, in the end, I can do super broken stuff really early.
Yeah.
The only thing I could think of is that it's colorless mana that you're getting, which maybe that's why
it is slightly less powerful.
Yeah.
I'm not
but at the same time, there
the
are
right
so
deck.
Many Esper control decks that, or, you know, just like you said, Ulamog, or, you know, things that can happen that are just broken completely on this. I don't know if I agree with this Metalworker on banning, but.
This is the one.
See what happens.
I would not be surprised if in a year or a couple years or whatever they reban this card.
Just because of new cards that are coming out too.
Yeah,
unless they're
going to
print it again. I mean, that would be interesting.
But they don't know
this.
No. EDH and Commander Banlist is not run by Wizards of the Coast. So they don't. The people doing the Banlist, they have no information based on what's being printed, reprinted, whatever. So they're not doing it based on that. They think this card is not broken.
Yeah, and
I am going to go and prove them wrong.
Yeah, I'm definitely putting him in. I'm making an artifact deck now. I can use him. The only thing I can think of is that he hurts himself essentially, because you're going to play those cards in your hand with the mana you use, so he gets less and less each turn. But there's so many ways to just draw more cards.
I mean,
in
how
your
many
hand.
Times in Commander are you standing there or sitting there and you're holding like 15, 20 cards? It happens all the time. So if you're doing that.
And in, I'm just thinking, in Esper colors where you can recur him, now you can, my God, it's like, he's definitely going in Shroom, I know that.
He's amazing. If you have an artifact-based deck or a deck with a lot of artifacts, go put Metalworker in it right now.
Yep, pretty much.
It's awesome.
There's no reason you shouldn't have him in there if you can get him. He's a little hard to get, as we like to say.
I was just going to say, is everywhere sold out of him right now?
I wonder what the price did. Did it spike up a
lot? It went up about $7. And it's still climbing.
Hey, the power of Commander, though.
Yeah. But relative to its original price, I think it was sitting around 20, and so it's been bumped up since then. I traded one away recently.
$27 now?
Yeah. I never.
Bucks.
Here's that.
Well,
I traded one away. I was like,
banned.
This is never going to get unbanned. Look at this thing. I was like, this is ridiculous. He gets unbanned. Great.
You still have a couple, right?
Yeah.
Oh, man. All right, let's move on to our main topic, Khans of Tarkir. We talked about everybody's so excited about it. I wanted to really quickly just go through the mechanics in Khans, just talk about them really quickly, and just how they relate to EDH. So the Abzan, which is...
White, black, green. I got you covered.
Okay, good. Thank you. White, black, green, Abzan. They are the Endurance of the Dragon, and their mechanic is called Outlast. And how it works is you pay some amount of mana, and then you tap the creature, and the creature gets a 1/1 counter. And you can only play this as a sorcery. And that last part, the fact that you can only play as a sorcery, is actually the most important part. Because
absolutely.
I think this mechanic would be pretty great.
It'd be pretty broken.
Oh, so unbelievably broken.
Yeah, I mean, it would be usable in EDH, but not broken.
Right.
If it was as an instant. But yeah, because of Limited... Basically, they have to make it be played as a sorcery, and that pretty much means that I think in EDH it's just not worth it.
I don't think Outlast is going to do much in EDH, but I think a lot of the fact that they introduced these wedge color, you know, cards that we, you know, we had Shards of Alara before, and, you know, and all of the Alara block, and this finally takes it to the other side. I mean, for me, the Abzan colors, white, black, green, have been my favorite since I started playing. You know, when I started playing was the 2011 Commander cycle, so I immediately built Agave and a Carador deck, and I'm thrilled. And I'm thrilled to see that, you know, they finally kind of embraced that and introduced it in the same set that has fetch lands and, you know, all this other stuff that's just awesome.
Yeah, I agree about the fact that they're printing cards for those wedges, and that's going to be good for us. But I just mean this mechanic in general. I just think, can find stuff that does better things than this. It's just going to be super slow, super clunky.
And as you look through the set, I think we'll find that the cards that have a universal effect for creatures that have +1/+1 counters on it are much more important, because those affect the limited structure, but there's also a lot of cards in the history of Magic that will give you +1/+1 counters. So that's where the Abzan sort of shines in EDH. The next group is Jeskai, and they're the cunning of the clans. They are blue, red, and white. And their main effect is prowess.
America!
Yeah, they are America. And their main effect is prowess, which is this creature gets +1/+1 until end of turn every time you play a non-creature spell.
The important thing to note about that is non-creature spell doesn't have to be an instant or a sorcery. I mean, if you play an artifact, that's non-creature. Yeah, an enchantment. So, again, it's mostly for limited, it feels like.
Yeah.
It just doesn't feel like it's going to be enough of a gain in EDH to abuse this mechanic, at least not right now.
Yeah, and very rarely are you just sitting there being like, if only I had one more power and toughness to trade with this guy, then I'd be up on board.
Yeah, it's EDH. He's just going to not block you and be like, okay, I take two more damage.
Out of my 40.
So instead of 38 at 38, I'm at 36. Are you done?
Yeah.
The only thing I can think of for a reason to play something like this would be something like Helava or Talrand, where you're built around instants and sorceries or other things that you're not playing a lot of other creatures. I haven't really taken too much of a look at this. I don't really know what the creatures offer, but if there's something in there,
I mean,
those would be the two.
You could maybe do a lot of cantrips, so a lot of spells that draw you other cheap spells like quickens and stuff like that, and just like chain together like storm, kind of chain together like a whole bunch of stuff. And then, but if you're doing that, just play storm.
Yeah,
just play storm. It's gonna be better, because then you do all that and they go path to exile. Crap. But he was at 28-28 before he died. I'm not saying prowess is horrible. If it's on a creature that's otherwise okay, you could play it.
Exactly.
But you're not playing it because of prowess.
Definitely not.
So the next clan mechanic is Sultai.
Black, green, blue.
Black, green, and blue. Or and bug. They are the ruthlessness of the dragon. Their mechanic is Delve. Delve, you can reduce the mana cost of the spell by one colorless for each card you exile from your graveyard. So if a spell costs like one black and seven colorless, and you had five cards in your graveyard, you can exile all five of them, and now it will cost one black and two colorless. So it's a loophole in the mana costs that you can pay. Yeah, these types of mechanics, I think, are okay. It's just looking at most of the Delve cards, and we'll get into them later, they're just costed so high that I don't think they're going to be better than what you can find.
And it's definitely a build-around-me mechanic, because you'll definitely have more cards in your graveyard in EDH, but you also have to have a way to put them there. Because otherwise
really
you're going to run out of gas, you know?
Yeah. So you'd have to build a deck that's putting a bunch of stuff in its graveyard on purpose, and then maybe these cards get a little bit better. Even then, Murder is going to be better most of the time than this, and you're going to want to reanimate those cards, or you're going to want to dredge, or a lot of stuff where you're...
Yeah.
Are you really going to want to exile all those cards?
If you're putting stuff in your bin with a color that's like these colors, you're going to want to dredge them back up.
Yeah.
And if, like you guys always say, if you judge a card on its, you know, every condition that it could be in, these are typically late game cards. They're typically not as advantageous early on.
True.
Yeah, and I think in the limited format, it's going to be best you can only play a couple of these.
Yeah. Because
you're going to get limited use out of how much gas you got in your garbage.
I think Jimmy, you made a really good point, actually. If you're playing a deck that's putting stuff in your own yard, you're doing that because you're using your graveyard as a resource.
Yeah.
It's like the cards in your graveyard are similar to cards in your hand.
It's the second.
And in that case, you don't actually want to exile them. You want access to them. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I just don't see it. I don't see it being super useful. Somebody might prove me wrong, but I don't see it being super useful.
Yeah. And we'll talk about it, because each of these clans also has a legendary creature that's the clan leader. And we'll definitely talk about if they're effective as commanders. The next group is Mardu, which is definitely my colors. It's speed. And as you might be able to guess, it has red in the color. And it's also got white and black, which I think is really interesting. And their main effect is called Raid. where you get a bonus effect if you have attacked with a creature this turn. So this refers mostly to your second main phase.
Yeah, right. Like usually you're going to attack with something and then on your second main play a raid card and you'll get additional effect. This mechanic is okay in EDH. It's usable. Just because the way that multiplayer works, usually if you want to attack somebody, you can find somebody that's like open to an attack from one of your guys.
Yeah, for a tiny amount of damage.
Yeah, somebody doesn't have a flyer or somebody just doesn't have any creatures at all or somebody has creatures that are smaller than your biggest one or you've got a 1-1 death touch guy and you know they're just not going to want to block it. And you can usually just find a way in. Or, I mean, worst comes to worst, you can just attack. You don't have to actually deal any damage. They can block and kill the thing.
Yeah,
but if you
exactly.
want, if you want to trigger raid, then you can do it.
And I think that's what we're going to see in Limited, too, is you're going to just sometimes throw a guy in so you can get that extra effect.
Yeah. And I think so. Some of these cards could be useful in EDH. I don't think you build a whole deck around it, but...
Well, people would murder you because they're like, you're about speed and trying to beat us with aggro.
You might win a lot of games, actually.
Yeah, people, you might win one-on-one.
People build slow EDH decks.
Yeah.
True. If it's more than three people total, if there's four people, you're going to lose. Yeah.
Everyone's going to raise a skeptical eye and you'll be like, what is this guy doing? And you're literally going like, I'm just playing as fast as I can. And they're like, okay, let's kill him then.
Okay, you're dead.
Yeah.
And the last clan is called Temur. They are the ferocity and savagery of the dragon. And wait, don't tell me. It's green, red, and blue.
Ding, 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 ding.
I just know that because it's the Riku colors.
That's right.
And their mechanic is called Ferocious. And what Ferocious is that you get an additional effect if you control a creature with power 4 or greater. So the effect could come when you cast it. Some of cards say, oh, when you attack with this guy, if you control a creature with 4 or greater, you get this effect. Actually, I think in Commander, this is going to be a lot easier to trigger.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah, just because in general, we just play bigger creatures with higher casting cost, and there's more likely to be a 4-4 or bigger on your side of the table. I mean, like in Standard...
Or 4-1.
Yeah.
You know,
in Standard, there's some decks that just don't even have anything that's power 4 or greater, like in the whole deck. I doubt there's a Commander deck. There's probably a few. Maybe the Gaddock Teed deck.
It has
a lot of big creatures.
Like
Talran, Sky Sarin,
something that I
can
think of.
You don't have any creatures in that deck.
There's a few, but there's not too many.
So, but most of the time, I think in an EDH atmosphere, like you're going to be able to trigger Ferocious. It's not going to be too difficult.
Mm-hmm. I think Ferocious and Raid are. I'd like to see which one is more apt for Commander.
Right,
I feel like they're both equally kind of on the same page because one, you know, the power 4 or greater is typically later game. The earlier one, you can trigger kind of, you know, with any aggro deck or anything like that. And like you were saying, to just attack and die, whatever.
It'll also depend, I think, a lot on the colors because the ferocious creatures are going to be in Temur's colors and the Mardu ones are going to be in the raid colors. And the only colors I think they share are red.
It's just red, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, and the last mechanic, actually the most interesting maybe, is Morph. So Morph is a little bit complicated, but the way it works is a Morph card, you can always play it for 3 colorless mana, and it's a colorless 2-2 creature, no creature type. And then you can pay the Morph cost on the card at any time, and you can flip it up, and then it becomes the card that it is. This sounds a little bit confusing. It's basically like you play a creature and nobody knows what it is. And that any time if you have the mana available or whatever the requirement is, they're not all mana. It's like it's hiding and then it morphs into the thing that it is.
Yeah, the art they have for the card is the tokens this time around, I think, explains it pretty well. It's like this weird energy ball that's flying downhill.
Yeah,
and you are at some point able to cast the right amount of mana for it to explode into whatever it's supposed to be. And it almost always has an effect when it gets turned over or enters the battlefield. Mostly when it's turned over. And usually in Khans of Tarkir, almost all the morph costs are very similar to the actual casting cost of the card. So if a card was like 1 and 3 red, there's nothing like that, the morph cost would be just 3 red. So it would just cost 1 less. But you are losing a turn when you play it because you can't usually play it and morph it that same turn. You won't have the mana too.
Oh, and about the token, it's important to note that the morph card does not create a token when you put it into play. The token that they've created, that says 2-2 creature on it, is just to remind you that it is a morph card. So it's not like there's a 2-2 that exists separately as a token. It's the card is actually the 2-2. So when you flip it over, you take that token back off the table. I think that might be a little bit confusing for some people.
Yeah, and some of the rules also about morph, if you're not playing online, you have to show the morph card if it ever dies or is removed or in any way is taken and is supposed to be flipped face up because you don't want to just be like, I play a forest for its morph cost. You know.
Yeah, it's a guard to check against cheating. So Yeah, if you're playing in a competitive setting, then yeah, if the game's over or somebody bounces that morph card back to your hand, or they put it on top of your library, they tuck it into your deck, you're required at that point to show the card and prove that it's an actual morph card, because like Jimmy said, you could be like playing an island as a 2/2 creature otherwise.
Yeah. And the last little thing is the little rules bit. For those of you that know how the stack works intricately, morph does actually not use the stack. It is called a quote unquote special action. Which means you can pay the mana at any time to flip it over. You just have to have priority. It won't be something that goes on the stack. It's not something that your opponent can respond to. So you're able to just flip it as long as you have the mana.
So it's hard to get screwed over.
Yeah,
basically.
Exactly. Yeah. You can't. For instance, if it's a 2/2 and you say I'm going to pay its morph cost to flip it, they can't lightning bolt it for 3 and kill it before it gets flipped over. Yeah. You paid the mana, it will flip over and become a 0/6 or whatever, and then take the damage. All right.
Okay, I think that covers the mechanics. So now we're going to go through the colors and then the multicolored and everything. We're just going to pick out the cards that we think are going to have some impact on EDH.
All right. We are starting with black, and our first card here is Blood-Soaked Champion. For a single black, he is a 2/1 human warrior that cannot block, and he has the raid mechanic. For 1 and a black, return Blood-Soaked Champion from your graveyard to the battlefield. Activate this ability only if you attack with a creature this turn.
Okay, the thing I like about this guy is you can use him to trigger himself. So what you can do is you attack with the Blood-Soaked Champion, and then during the declare blockers phase, if they block him, you can just use a sack outlet and sack him. And then during your second main, you've attacked with a creature. It was the Blood-Soaked Champion. Doesn't matter. And now you bring him right back into play for 1 and a black. So it's a great with sack outlets. And then if they don't block him, you can just hit him for 2 damage and do the same thing.
And sack him in your second main phase.
And then bring him back because you attacked with a creature that turn. So,
or, you know, maybe the 2 power is enough to kill their blocker.
Yeah.
You know, you never know. So he's great. He's got super amounts of recursion in him. And if you sack him to, like, Phyrexian Altar or the other altar, you essentially have half the mana you need.
True. Although if you sack during the combat phase, then it won't come out of the combat phase. So you'd have to do that during
the combat phase. So just leave him swinging, and if he dies, he'll bring him back, right?
Yeah, well, I think there's a lot of decks that just have sack outlets, and they have sack outlets that let them do things. I mean, let's say you had, I don't know what deck this would go in, but let's say you had Jaleera.
Mm-hmm.
And so what you can do is you attack with him, and then you use him with Jaleera, who basically
pops
says,
out a new person.
Sack him, and then flip cards over from the top of your deck until you find a creature and put that directly into play.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and if it's if you've managed to stack the top of your deck, you could get Ulamog for him, and then bring him right back and do it again.
Non-legendary.
Oh, non-legendary.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Otherwise, Jaleera would be busted.
Don't do Ulamog. You'd be cheating. Do something big, though.
Instead, take the Ulamog and morph him for 3 mana.
Yeah. Do Stormtide Leviathan.
There you go.
Done.
Yeah, exactly. Cheat out anyone that's fat.
Okay, so, yeah. Next card is called... Oh, this one was named by friend of the show, James Bianca.
Yeah.
It's called Empty the Pits.
This is a card for you, Craig. I feel like you'd like this.
Big time mana, yeah.
This is 4 black and X and then X. I don't even know if that's how you're supposed to explain it.
I think that's the most mana symbols I've ever seen on the card outside of, like, Chromat.
It's an instant. It has Delve, which, as we recall, means that you can pay for the colorless part of the mana cost by exiling any number of cards from your graveyard. It says, put X 2/2 black zombie creature tokens onto the battlefield tapped. So you pay 4 swamps. And then you have to pay X twice. So if you also pay 6 other mana, that would be 3 and 3, and you get 3/2/2 zombies, which doesn't really sound very appealing.
3/2/2 zombies for 10 mana.
Yeah, that's. But it has Delve.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say you had 20 cards in your graveyard.
Boom.
Now you pay that same amount. You pay 4 swamps, 6 mana, exile 20 cards from your graveyard.
13.
So you get 13 2/2s.
You know what I like better than that?
What?
Army of the Damned.
Yeah, because you know what you're getting every time.
Exactly.
And it's cheaper.
The only thing that's not good about it, well, that's better about this is that this is an instant. But it, like you said, getting rid of all those creatures in your graveyard, I can see this working a lot with like Cabal Coffers and what's the other one? And Urborg, Tomb of Yawgmoth. You know, in a mono black deck, I could see something like this
kind of
happening.
Oh, where you just get a lot of black. Yeah, this card's interesting.
You just create like a ton of mana, and then, yeah, you know what this card would probably work with is Metalworker. You just stack your hand with like 15 artifacts, it just boom.
Yeah.
I mean, you need that. But if you have Urborg, you're good. Whatever your lands out are swamps. Yeah.
I think this is an interesting card. I think this is going to have a hard time finding its way into EDH. Like, I think at first glance, it looks really good.
Yeah.
But I think in practice, the four black is... They don't put four black on a lot of stuff because it's very hard to get there unless you're running mono color.
I like what you said. Army of the Damned? A million times better in almost every circumstance.
Everything comes into play tapped, but it's like you have 13 of them. You can do it again.
Yeah. And our example just had 13, but it was at the extra cost of 20 cards from your graveyard.
Right.
I mean, honestly, the entertainment in me is like, all right, this is just like a last-ditch effort spell. If like you're at the end of your game and you're like, I have to do something, I got it. I'm going to mill my deck into my library until I have two cards in my library and 98 cards or whatever, a bunch of cards. I'm going to cast Empty the Pits at empty instant speed at the end of the turn, and then I can win.
And then somebody goes...
Rakdos Charm.
Faded Retribution?
Yeah, right.
Rakdos Charm. There's a million things that just... No, I don't love it. Army of the Damned, everybody. Go with Army of the Damned.
All right, next up is Grim Haruspex. It's 2 and 1 black for 3 total. It's a morph card, so you can play it for 3 as a 2/2. You can morph it for just 1 black mana, and it says, whenever another non-token creature you control dies, draw a card.
Yeah, I liked this card. Well, it's really good with the Bloodsoaked Champion.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can just... It can be a draw engine. Anything that's draw engine is good in general. And also because our first episode, we talked about Marchesa, and Marchesa was about reoccurring creatures, continuously sacking them, and then they keep coming back into play.
Yeah.
There's a lot of cards in Magic's history that do that. So I think this deck will find a home, this card will find a home in those decks.
Yeah. I like the card. I think it has... It's another draw outlet, which is nice too. And you're going to lose creatures. And I don't think black has too many options for card draw. So,
That's what I like about this most.
Black has quite a bit, but it usually cost you life.
Yeah.
Right. Or they're very high mana cost. What I like about this is it's a lower mana cost, it's a body. It's also, it has a lot of advantages to it.
You could also put it down for its morph cost. And then if somebody just happens to board wrath you, you just flip it over and you go, at least I get to draw 6 more cards.
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I think this is a pretty solid card. You always just need to draw cards in EDH. So.
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay, the next one is called Keru Bloodsucker. Keru? Sure. Whenever... It's a 2 and a black for a creature vampire, 2/2.
Does not look like a vampire.
No,
it
doesn't.
Like something demonic.
It looks like... I don't know. It looks like his
arms.
Looks like a Gumby zombie.
That's a great description.
Did you like how I paused for you guys to laugh?
Yeah,
before?
Come on, laugh. I looked at it and I was like, that is a Gumby zombie.
It also rhymes.
Yeah.
Okay. It says, whenever a creature you control with toughness 4 or greater dies, each opponent loses 2 life and you gain 2 life. Plus, it has an activated ability. Pay 2 and a black, sacrifice another creature, put a 1/1 counter on Keru Bloodsucker.
Right.
So I always look out for these effects that hit all of my opponents. Because if I can find a way to recur a 4/4 or bigger, a creature with toughness 4 or bigger, then I can just be continuously dinging people. And if I can do that a few times in a turn, if there's a way to bounce a creature directly into play repeatedly after it's died, which there's cards that do things like this, you could really stack up like a lot of damage and gain a lot of life like pretty quickly.
Yeah, and it's also like this card I really love because of its second ability. I'm always looking for cards that have sack outlets built into them. It's such an important thing in EDH to have sack outlets because you're always going to want to get extra utility out of your creatures, and if your opponents don't have that sort of option, you're going to be a step ahead of them in the game too.
How good is this card in Marchesa? Because you need sack outlets. You're going to sack something. It's going to come back into play because of Marchesa, and it puts a +1/+1 counter on him, which protects him from dying.
And you don't need to tap him, so you can use it at instant speed as soon as he's in the battlefield.
Yeah. And not to mention, this combo is great with something like Sanguine Bond, which is whenever you gain life, each opponent loses that much life, so it doubles it immediately.
Is that an infinite combo?
No, it's not.
Because it doesn't also gain you life.
Oh, right.
It would only lose 4, and you'd gain 2.
Yeah.
Everybody.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anytime you're dealing damage to the entire table indiscriminately, it's powerful.
Yeah, we found that out when we drafted Conspiracy. Another card that also helps out with Marchesa is Merrick Nightblade, which is an Outlast guy, but he gives each creature you control the +1/+1 counter on it, Death Touch. And so that's super powerful in Marchesa, because now you can be freely swinging in with stuff. You don't need to just hold them back. You know, now all your creatures have an additional ability that is
and nobody
really
can attack you either, because, yeah. You know.
Those are typically my favorite creatures in this set. The ones that say everything with a +1/+1 or yeah. one counter gets
That's
this.
What you can build around. The Outlast mechanic itself doesn't do that a ton for you, but if you're given, because you can play with modular cards, or you can play with undying cards, or you can play with graft cards. You know, there's a lot of cards that either come into play with +1/+1 counters, or they just have ways to get them very easily. And then, now you're playing. It's basically like an anthem effect for all of those creatures.
Yeah, right. Very nice. All right, let's move on to red.
Jimmy.
What?
I was just going to say, why do you want to talk about red?
I don't know. I've just been seeing all these beautiful red cards on this page, and I'm looking at and... Guys, red. Do you guys know that red's a color in Khans of Tarkir?
What's your favorite color in Khans of Tarkir, Jimmy?
It would be the red clan. I think there's...
The red clan.
The first card is Burn Away. It's a 5-mana, 4/1 red for an instant. Burn Away deals 6 damage to target creature. And here's the nice wording on this. When that creature dies this turn, exile all cards from its controller's graveyard.
It's interesting.
Yeah,
I really like... effects like this that we've talked about many times do two things at once. So it's a lot of times you don't really want to put a dedicated just hose people's graveyard card in your deck, like Tormod's Crypt or something, because it does nothing if they're not playing, if they don't care about their graveyard. And you know, what's the percentage of decks that actually use their graveyard? It's not that many. But then when somebody is, it totally sucks, because you're like, I wish I could get rid of their graveyard. So now you've got a card, and if nobody's playing a graveyard themed deck, then you can at least still kill something with it. It still does something.
Yeah,
but if
five
they are,
six is acceptable.
Yeah, but if they are playing a graveyard shenanigan deck, you just completely hose their deck.
Which I think is cool about this set specifically is that, and you know what they're doing with red recently, because I heard your earlier podcast with Alex Kessler, and you know you guys were talking about how red was typically not the best commander color, in the past. In red, you are typically not pulling that much from your graveyard. If you are pulling from your graveyard, it's typically, Past in Flames or something like that.
Maybe a flashback card. Yeah, not
right,
exactly.
Right.
It's not your central theme.
But something like this, where you're dealing 6 damage to somebody and getting rid of their graveyard at instant speed, can be an answer to, I recur this from my graveyard. No, you don't. And, your creature dies.
Yeah.
And there's going to be something that dies to 6 damage. Like
now,
that kills most everything.
That's actually a really good point, because even decks that aren't dedicated to graveyard shenanigans, a lot of decks have like a way or two to use something in their graveyard.
Like Genesis,
and so it's like,
or
yeah,
any,
it's like,
kind
oh,
of
you're
person.
Not like going to reanimate all your stuff, but you might flash back something or do something out of there, and boom, just.
And this
get rid
is a way
of
exiling that creature as well. So if, say a Micaeus the Unhallowed is really chapping your butt,
absolutely.
You know, this is like, okay, no, not anymore.
I think this card was actually built to answer the standard problem of the Soul of New Phyrexia or any of the souls, because they have an ability you can use from the graveyard. This makes sure that they can't do it. You know?
Oh, interesting. Yeah, and it does
exactly
6 damage.
6 damage, I didn't think about it until I read it just now.
Smart guy. The next card is called Howl of the Horde. This was also named by James Pianca.
James is killing it,
he's
by the way.
He's pretty prolific.
We have a couple more.
Yeah, he's one of the fetch lands, too.
Yeah.
Oh, he has Flavor Text.
Flavor
he didn't
text,
name it,
yeah.
but still. Well, he couldn't name it. They were already named. That would have been awesome. I named Flooded Plain.
I renamed it, guys. I just added an extra N at the end. So it's
James,
flooded.
I would call liar on that one. So just don't try it.
Don't morph that on us.
So, Howl of the Horde. It's 2 and a red for a sorcery. It says, when you cast your next instant or sorcery spell this turn, copy that spell. You may choose new targets for the copy. But it has raid. So, there's a lot of text. But what happens is if you have raid, which means if you attacked with the creature that this turn, do it again. So basically copy it twice. This seems extremely powerful to me.
For 3 mana.
EDH. It's 3 mana to copy a spell twice if you have raid. Even if you only get to copy it once. I mean, a card like Fork, which is 2 red. Does that twin cast 2 blue?
Yeah.
Does that? Those are totally awesome cards, because in EDH we're playing cards that say, give me 2 extra turns, make 13 2/2 zombies. You know, do you want to make 39 2/2 zombies?
Imagine
yes, please.
This guy in Hullaba.
Oh,
yeah, exactly.
Oh, just so much repeatability.
Wait, you call her that too?
I list to you guys.
That's true.
I just hope that's becoming a thing out there.
Yeah.
Work with Alex Kessler.
Yeah. I mean, definitely one of the things is like you want ways to double stuff up in red. That's when you're really getting like out of a burn spell or anything. There's a lot of ways to kill people, and red has a lot of just fun ways that if you can double it, makes it a lot better than like just sort of any other spell that you could be playing.
And they've had other, you know, copy something once and whatnot, and typically they're like two red or two blue, which is harder to get to. Something like this, it's three, but it's only one red. So, you know, it's not an instant like a lot of the others, but it has some really cool abilities. I'm interested to see where this goes.
I don't think it's too hard to just do something crazy with this card. I mean, instead of two extra turns, you get six extra turns. That's called I win.
It's called I win the game, yeah.
In Nekusar, I like to fork a Wheel of Fortune. Well, let's just play three Wheel of Fortunes. Everybody draws seven cards, discards, draws seven cards, discards, draws seven more cards. Yeah. That's 21 damage to everybody.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
That should kill half the table.
There's
by the
just
point
so
you
many
that.
Broken things. Anything that doubles up something you're already going to do is going to be powerful because we're a singleton format. So all our cards are individually powerful, and you can, you know, and we're allowed to do it because you can only play one of them. Well, this lets you play three of them.
Mm-hmm. Oh my God. Imagine Mirari-ing this. Like playing something this and then Mirari.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of doubling you can do.
There's a lot of shenanigans. This is just amazing. Yeah. You could. I could see scenarios where you brain geyser everybody out. You know, or something like that. There's like James Pianca's deck where he
Metal
has a
Worker
million
and then Brain Geyser and then this.
Yeah. Although, it doesn't have red in it, but yeah. Metal Worker, Brain Geyser, Howl of the Horde, game.
Yeah.
Craig just broke the format.
Yeah, you can even do it on yourself for just like a draw spell.
Who said mono red wasn't good?
Yeah. No.
Yeah, that's true. If you have a moderate draw spell, you can all of a sudden triple it up.
Busted.
So it's like instead of drawing five, you draw 15. Like, that's a huge difference.
Yeah. And it's, you may choose new targets. So you can be like, nope. It's all me.
It's all me.
The next big one we have is Sarkhan the Dragon Speaker. And we talked about this on a podcast two episodes ago, I believe, with Marshall. Sarkhan is just basically a really fun planeswalker. He is five total man with four loyalty. His plus one, he becomes a legendary 4/4 red dragon creature with flying, indestructible, and haste. And he doesn't lose loyalty when he's not a planeswalker, which is the first time we've seen that. His minus three, he just deals four damage to a creature. And his minus six is you get an emblem with, at the beginning of your draw step, draw two additional cards, and at the beginning of your end step, discard your hand. So it's definitely got the red theme of like you get to draw cards, but at a price.
Right.
Right? Like aggressive mining.
You're drawing three cards.
Yeah,
that's
exactly.
That's a lot. In mono red, it's great because in mono red, it just has real trouble drawing cards. I think if you're paired with basically any other color, then you don't even want to ultimate him.
Yeah, exactly.
The thing I like about him is he gets around board wipes, at least sorcery speed board wipes.
Yeah.
Because, you know, they can wipe the board and the planeswalker is still going to be there. He's not super brokenly powerful. Unfortunately.
He's definitely he's a player. In the game. He's not the leader. He's not a guy that comes in and makes any deck specifically busted. But he's got a lot of utility for red because red just doesn't have that much card draw either.
Yeah. I mean, he's a planeswalker. We're going to talk about him. He doesn't belong in a lot of decks, but if you have him, you can find a place. And people are going to just throw him in there.
I hope I don't get chastised for this, but I really don't see the big deal about him. He's like only indestructible on your turn. He can deal three damage to something, but at five mana, that's a ton.
Yeah.
And, his last ability, it's cool, to draw extra two cards. And in mono red, I could see with mono red burn, I could see his place in limited.
I'd like to see him in a...
And in standard.
And in standard,
right.
I think in EDH, he's not going to quite get there yet.
I'd love to see a dragon-themed deck and having Sarkhan just as one of the cards in there, because I think that'd be fun. With Dragonstorm and all the, the red dragons you can get.
Yeah, true,
and
true.
Having, that would be a nice flavorful card. The last red card I wanted to talk about is Barrage of Boulders, which is a sorcery speed 2-1 red, and it deals one damage to each creature you don't control. So that's great for EDH. It's going to hit an entire board. But more importantly, it's a ferocious trigger, so if you control a creature with power 4 or greater, creatures can't block this turn. For three mana, you can essentially seal your victory if you are able to attack. So in a deck that has, like Animar, sometimes you just need, all you need to do is like swing with three of your biggest guys and you'll kill them. But if they can chump block them, then what's the matter? They don't have trample necessarily. Barrage of Boulders is nice because you can you target everyone. All those creatures can't block. You can just start swinging away at as many people as you want. And I think this is one of the more effective ways to blow out the game and potentially win by killing like several people on one turn.
Yeah, I'm not a huge fan of this card. I just think, it's good against token decks because the one damage will actually matter. But it's a sorcery, so you can find things that are going to do one damage to everything that are at a better speed for you.
Practice charm.
Yeah, and the falter effect part of it, which is what we call when you make things unblockable, is good. But, you know, a lot of times, even if you can kill one person, you're not attacking because the other two people will crack back and kill you. So I just feel like in EDH, there's so many times where it's not the fact that they can block you that's really stopping you. It's the crackback from the other players. And so this doesn't solve that part of the equation. And usually, like, hey, if I can attack you and kill you and not lose anything, then I'm not worried about your blockers anyway.
See, now what I do like about this, to contradict your point slightly, is that with something like this, it affects, like Jim said, everybody's creatures, everybody, except for you. Even you, I guess you can't block during the turn that you attack.
Right. But it's sorcery, so it's your turn.
Right. Well, so, but what you can do from there is now you can choose, okay, let's say, Josh, you're the strong person on the board.
That's right.
And you have a ton of creatures, and Jim has nothing, and it's us three playing. I can, with this card, now choose you as the one to die and deal with Jimmy the next turn. So the crackback may be less severe.
It's true.
You can take care of, like, the big guy.
It's true. I just feel like that scenario is pretty specific, and most of the time the scenario is there's four people at the table. I could kill maybe one person, but the other two can kill me if I do that. And so what happens is the whole board is stalled out, and this card doesn't break that stall for me. It'll allow you to attack with two of your guys, but that probably won't kill them.
Yeah.
Well, so it's just like, I'd rather have Amphim Pathmage. It just makes things unblockable for three mana. Like, you know, in a lot of scenarios, it's like, well, I'll just make two things unblockable. I'll attack with those. I'll still have some blockers back, and I'll just chip away. Because, you know, if I just swing with everything and I have no blockers left, you know, I'm not saying it's completely unusable.
I just see it in creature-heavy decks.
Yeah.
If you're a red deck like Annamar, this could be your win condition, one of your few win conditions.
Yeah, I think red aggro could use this potentially. Yeah.
And the other downside is, of course, if you're playing a mono-red deck, you're better off just going infinite with Kiki Jiki and, like, Zealous Constructs.
Yeah, exactly. Do you really want to use a card on this when, you know,
your deck
you can have you can have Splinter Twin or Kiki Jiki as one of your cards, and then you're going to have Barrage of Boulders? I don't know. I just don't see it.
I'd be a better popper card in that case. Anyway, let's move on to green. The first card we got here is Hardened Scales. It's a one green enchantment, and it's pretty simple. If one or more +1/+1 counters will be placed on the creature you control, that many +1/+1 counters are placed on it instead.
+1.
Yeah. That many +1.
So it doesn't double them. It just gives you one additional.
One more.
Yeah. It's in the mold of Parallel Lives, Doubling Season, that kind of stuff. So we wanted to talk about it. It's not completely super powerful, but I can't see it being used in decks where +1/+1 counters matter, because you can get to a point where, like, I don't know, there's cards that say put a +1/+1 counter on all your creatures.
Yeah,
well,
some
elves
do that.
If you put two on everything, all of a sudden, like, you can just win.
And something like this, you know, like I was talking about earlier, that Abzan's my favorite, and, you know, I built those two generals. Gave, this is going immediately in Gave.
Yeah.
Because now you start putting +1/+1 counters on things, you create two of them, you sack one to create a token, and blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, it's just a nice, and it costs one green. I think that's the big appeal. It's just something you can lay down, like Exploration.
Yeah,
it's easy to put down and immediately affects your board state.
Yeah, really good point. The cost is so low that you can actually hold it in your hand and then play it out the same turn you're going to do the +1/+1 counter thing. Works good with some of the Ajani's. Yeah, there's a lot of ways to use it. I don't put it in your deck if you've only got a couple cards that put +1/+1 counters on stuff. Put it in your deck if that's one of the sub themes of your deck, or maybe even
the main sub theme.
Okay, the next card is called, I like this one, Hooded Hydra.
Yeah, this guy's awesome.
Yeah,
I love the art too.
It's a snake hydra. It costs green and X, and it's a 0/0. So you might guess something's going to happen here. Hooded Hydra enters the battlefield with X +1/+1 counters on it. So if you play green and six, it's a 6/6. When Hooded Hydra dies, put a 1/1 green snake creature token onto the battlefield for each +1/+1 counter on it.
Value.
Yeah. It's also a morph card. It costs 3/2 green to flip it over. And when it's turned up, you put 5 +1/+1 counters on it. So you can sort of, like, make it a 5/5 for five if you make it a 2/2 for three on turn three. Anyway, in EDH, I don't see you doing that very often. You're probably going to hold it in your hand because you're going to be able to create a whole bunch of mana, and you're going to play it as a 20/20. And then if they happen to kill it, you get 21/1 snakes. It's kind of like Chasm's Skulker.
Chasm's Skulker, yeah, definitely. Yeah. Except you get to choose how many +1/+1 counters it comes in with. I like this card a lot.
Yeah. Anything that's resistant to a board wipe or resistant to being killed is like...
Yeah.
Yeah, because, I mean, if they...
Oh, yeah, this against a board wipe is so punishing. Someone sees that happen, they're like, ugh, I wish I didn't wrath.
Especially in a token deck, which is... I mean, which is where green lives.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, let's say you have Doubling Season out and they kill it and it's an 18/18. You make 36 dudes. Yep. let's say you also have something like Ogre.
Parallel Lives or Primal Vigor.
Or let's say you have like Ogre Battle Driver. Is that what it's called?
Yeah, Ogre Battle Master, I think.
Battle Master or Battle Driver, whatever that gives it anything.
Plus two, plus zero in haste.
Yeah, so it's battle like, driver, I made 36 dudes and they're three ones.
Yeah.
And they have haste. Everybody's dead. Everybody starts shuffling.
Everyone's like already cutting their soul rings back into their deck, sadly.
I can definitely see this guy
if you're
being
lucky enough to have soul ring out.
Yeah, right.
I can definitely see this guy being a token deck bomb.
Yeah.
You know, especially because a lot of token decks you're playing Altar, the one where sacrifice a creature.
Altar of Dementia?
Yeah.
No, Phyrexian Altar
So you can just sack them.
Sack them for either one color or for two colorless. And,
I mean, and it's resistant to board wipes, which token decks are really weak to.
And what I'm thinking is now you can cast him, let's say you have a bunch of tokens on the battlefield already, you cast him later for two green and you sack all your tokens to the altar for two colorless.
Make him even bigger.
Make him even bigger.
And then sack him to the altar and then boom, you've got, you know, from your other tokens, you're essentially feeding your own token machine.
Right. Holy crap, I didn't even think about
that. That's amazing. That's a great combo.
Doubling Season Parallel Lives, double the amount of counters you put on them initially, too.
Oh, yeah. Right. Yeah.
So if you go...
Oh, only geez. Doubling Season does. I don't think Parallel Lives.
Okay, so doubling Season. Yeah. So you go pay two green and six. He actually becomes a 12-12.
Right.
And then when he dies, you make 24 guys. So you quadrupled the amount.
Yeah. That's valuable.
Wow.
So imagine in Craig's scenario, now you have like 10, I don't know, 1-1 sapperlings out. You sacrifice 10 of those to one of the Phyrexian Altar, or I think it's Ashnod, so it gives you two colorless.
Ashnod,
so now you've got 20 mana. You play two green. You can play him for 20-20, and then he's doubled up to 40, and then you sack him again to the same outlet, and you
and
get 80. Yeah, and then you can sack all those for more mana to, I don't know, play Fireball.
To regrowth him and play him as an 80-80, play him with 80 mana, and then he's a 160-160, and then when he dies, you get 320. See how good I am at math?
Yeah, I like the doubling here.
I'm Asian. I'm good at math.
Bing, you got it. That's awesome. Ooh, excellent. Another James Pianca written card. James, you're like, you're helping out the EDH scene right now.
This card.
See the Unwritten.
Pretty awesome.
Yeah, it's 4 and 2 green. It's a sorcery. Reveal the top 8 cards of your library. You may put a creature card from among them onto the battlefield and put the rest into your graveyard. Or Ferocious, if you control a creature with power 4 or greater, you may put 2 creature cards on the battlefield instead of 1. So it's kind of like a tooth and nail.
It's like a fair tooth and nail?
Yeah, it's a fair tooth and nail.
Fair and nail.
Fair and nail, unless you stack the top of your deck somehow.
James, I'm sorry. I know you wrote See the Unwritten, but I just renamed it Fair and Nail.
That's excellent. I think this is better in a deck that wants some graveyard shenanigans. Because 8 cards, you might hit something that you really like or a creature that you didn't, you know, you had to choose between 3 awesome creatures. So you just put... so that you can still interact.
I don't think so. I think it's good in a deck where you're fixing the top of your deck.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's definitely where it's
best. I mean, Caridor and Kalia, or is it Kalia? No. Caridor and Damia come to mind with this. Typically you're playing big creatures, Caridor especially, you want stuff in your graveyard.
Mm-hmm.
And then Damia is like... You're just playing huge stuff, so
right,
yeah.
But I mean, you could go get these are any two creatures, right? It doesn't have the legendary thing, so
yep.
You can just put, you can do the same thing cards. You can do with tooth and nail, except for that it doesn't simultaneously tutor them. You have to have gone and found them. So it's like I said, just fair and nail. But you can literally win the game by just getting the right two creatures into play. So mm-hmm. You know, if you can fix the top of your deck, all you need is Brainstorm.
I'm gonna combine this with Howl of the Horde and do it for 16 cards and put 4 creatures out.
Ouch. Wait, if you attacked with a creature that turn, you can do it 3 times.
Oh, that's right. That's what I meant.
24 cards, put 6 creatures out.
Shaboom.
Then it is tooth and nail.
Yeah, essentially, at that point, you're probably going to hit the cards you want.
Yeah. This card is good.
Yeah. For 6
mana,
too.
It requires some setup. You've got to, like... But if you have Sensei's Divining Top, if you've got Scroll Rack, if you've got, you know, all these things that allow you to manipulate the top of your deck. We've talked about them before for Helluva.
Or even, you know, some of those, the creatures that when they're in your graveyard, they do extra stuff like Brawn or Anger or Genesis.
Yeah.
You know, which again, now Genesis is in your graveyard. Now you can stack it again if you can recur that through like that creature when it comes in, return a card.
Gravedigger,
yeah.
Any of them.
Or Eternal Witness. One. You're talking about like Revel Arc, or there's a million, but...
Yeah, E-Witness is the
E-Witness,
hot one.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm just not as worried about what I'm putting in my graveyard, because I'm more worried about what I'm putting directly into play for free. Well, it's not free, it's 6 mana, but I mean, you can put Ulamog and Kozilek, is he...
But the added benefits of having stuff in your graveyard, too, is something else to consider with this, because it's, you know,
yeah, you might as well
going into yeah. you know, yeah.
And green is one of the graveyard shenanigan colors, so yep. yeah, yeah. No, good point.
The last green card I want to talk about is actually the buy box promo, and I think this is a card that will definitely be valuable in the future. It's Rattleclaw Mystic. It's one in the green, and essentially kind of acts as a kind of like a Noble Hierarch in a way. It's got two abilities on it. The first is that it adds the teamer colors of green, blue, or red. And also, it's a morph card that when you turn it face up, you get green, blue, and red in your mana pool. So it gives you a little extra mana. It's a little fun.
It's one in a green for a 2/1 also. So yeah. you don't have to play it as a morph.
Exactly. But it's like, it's ramp. It's got the colors fixing you need. It's strong.
I really like this because, you know, let's say you're playing it in EDH and you're playing those colors. And let's say you're playing five colors. If you're mana screwed for any one of those colors, you play it for 3 face down. You play it next turn or the same turn for 2. Now you have all colors. It's great mana fixing.
It's true. You don't even need green to play it.
Right. Yeah, exactly. And you can get yeah. the other colors
out. I would say
out.
It's still not as good as Birds of Paradise or Sylvan Caryatid.
Yeah, of course not.
I just think in a deck like Animar where you can cast him for his morph cost, it's pretty strong. Just because if you, again, don't have the colors to get him out, you can reliably get him out turn 4, you know, unless you...
It's just really expensive. I mean, you're going to pay 5 mana to do it.
He's certainly not an every deck kind of card, but I think he definitely has his place, yeah. like an Animar or, you know, a 5-color deck where you do want to be a little bit more consistent.
I do yeah. like 5-color decks.
Indeed you do. All right.
All right, on to white. The first card we want to talk about is called Brave the Sands. It's 1 in white for an enchantment. It says creatures you control have vigilance.
Nice.
Each creature you control can block an additional creature. So we've talked about this in the past. I believe that blocking is actually way more important in EDH than it is in other formats. And vigilance is actually more important in EDH mm-hmm. than it is in other
Absolutely.
Formats. Because if you're playing with 3 other players, you're attacking once and you're on defense 3 times.
Yeah.
So having vigilance and being able to block an additional creature means you're just unassailable. I mean, if you have 3 creatures out, they have to have 6 creatures to get by you.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy.
I mean, you may trade with them, but at that same time, they're just like, is it worth to attack them?
Yeah, a lot of people won't even attack you, even if they have a profitable attack, because mm-hmm. it leaves them open to other players.
Yeah, they don't have vigilance.
Yeah, so if they can't kill you, they're going to be like, well, he'll chump block, and then I'm just open to attack for no gain.
Yeah.
This is pretty interesting, because this will probably replace Heliod in a few of my token decks. Mm-hmm. Even though mm-hmm. Heliod can make the tokens, you know, the vigilance factor is the same, but this costs 1 white, 1 other.
Yeah, it's yeah. very cheap.
And then can block, like you said, your blocking power is ridiculous. And with tokens, now you're
completely unassailable, I feel like. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Really, an uncommon, sun, too. This is like, this should have been a rare.
I think the rarity usually has to do with limited. And in limited, right. it's not as powerful because yeah. you don't have this broad range of strategies. And like some people are building a deck with only 1 creature and some people are building a deck that makes 600 creatures like that.
Yeah.
In limited, that doesn't happen. But EDH, right. all the time.
Yeah, exactly.
I do feel like, though, vigilance is one of my favorite abilities, yeah. period. It's so yeah. advantageous.
It shows that you're an EDH player, correct? Yeah. Because in regular Magic, it's not as important.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
But in EDH, it's super important because if I attack Jimmy, yeah. I want to make open. Sure that Craig right. and Kessler cannot crack back.
I love
me.
The idea of a token blowout with this, too, because it's like, all right, I'm going to swing with my 80 tokens at you. And block 4, I don't care.
And I'm not open. And I'm, yeah, not open. I'm not open to, yeah.
Cause
to
guess
getting
what?
Killed. Yeah.
And now
76.
I can block 164 yeah. of your creatures.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Craig's good at math, too.
Nice.
I think it was 162.
The next big one we have is the board wipe of white, and it's End Hostilities, 3 and 2 white. It's a sorcery, and it just says destroy all creatures and all a permanents attached to creatures. Oh, my gosh.
This is actually amazing in EDH.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Everything's getting
put
equipped.
Put it in your white deck you have. Put it in there. Because yeah. worst case scenario...
It's better than Wrath of God.
Well, situationally. So I have a lot of white decks that are Voltron-based.
True, true.
And I don't necessarily want to be running this in my Voltron based.
Put high market.
Well, this
in
is
there.
A sorcery, yeah, so I guess I could like unequip my stuff possibly.
No, put high market. You can't unequip, but you can equip to something else. But you put high market in. Sack your guy first, cast into hostilities. Because what does? Rafik deck. Totally
hosed.
Hoses
Rafik.
Yep.
Yeah. Any Voltron deck, any yep. Voltron deck, mm-hmm. hosed. Infect, you know, you put all that crap on there.
Hose. So you think this also has a place in a Voltron deck that you're playing?
Yes, yeah. because I'd say half the decks in the format are suit up your general in some way.
Yeah. Or suit
and
up a
they're
card.
Putting Whisper, like how many decks play Whisper Silk Cloak? Like everyone,
mm-hmm. everyone
Swiftfoot
yep.
Boots. How many? Like yeah. almost yep. every commander deck plays those cards. And why do they play them? Because they're trying to protect their commander. And what happens is you kill it once, you find some way around it, but then they get it out again and put Whisper Silk Cloak on it again, and you're in the yeah. same position you were in. Well, yep. if you can kill the Whisper Silk Cloak, yeah, now you're killing the problem.
Yeah, and yeah. for five mana, too. Like,
yeah, it's
I
only
pay five
one
mana,
more.
I pay five mana for a kill spell sometimes.
I
Holy
pay
crap.
Five mana for a ramp spell. It's called Gilded Lotus. That yeah. only just creates more mana.
Yeah, yeah exactly. No. And the nice thing is, too, it's like if you do have a Voltron deck, and let's say you're the target, and you get your Voltron commander knocked off, and your equipment falls to the side, it's like, thanks.
Big deal.
Here
but just think if
wide.
They killed all the equipment when they did it.
Oh,
you'd
my
be
gosh,
like,
yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
How am
I
going to win?
Is if your general does die by some means or something, now you can be like, all right, fine. End hostilities. Everyone yeah. else gets hosed. My equipment stays. I'll recast next turn.
Yeah. And like I said, if you were playing a Voltron deck, put High Market in. Put some a couple Sack Outlets in. You probably should have a couple anyway. Like every
yeah.
deck.
I have High Market in every
yeah,
deck.
Every deck would yeah. be better because they're going to go to tuck your general.
Yep.
Okay,
no,
I'll sack him first.
Exactly.
Yeah, like yeah. there's a lot of reasons why you want a sack outlet in almost every ADH deck, at least a couple. And this is just another reason.
Yeah.
The next one we want to talk about is called Erase. It's really simple. It's just the swords. It's enchantments to plowshares. It's one white for an instant exile target enchantment.
And it has nothing else to it. That's it.
That's it.
Yeah, no life gain.
What we've seen recently, what we've seen recently is a really big push towards more powerful enchantments.
And the
yeah.
fact that this one exiles them, so all of the
you
stuff from
really
Born
bad.
Of the Gods that's
yeah.
in, you know, that's indestructible,
like,
this gets rid of
I don't even
of.
Want to run Deicide anymore, because yep. how many gods is my opponent running too? I'd just rather have an Erase, cheaper, gone, yep. instant.
But, yeah, and there's so many gods as generals, like, yeah. they're a real yep. problem. Like, Krufix, we talked about that whole deck a few episodes ago, like, it's really part of the reason those decks work is because the general is really hard to deal with. It's just really yeah. hard to kill in any way, because it's an enchantment. And you can't use destroy enchantment. You need exile enchantment. And there's just not a ton mm-hmm. of those. And there's always going to be enchantments on the table. Like, yeah. you're hardly ever going to draw an Erase in a game and be like, crap, I can't use this.
Oh, my gosh. There's always something powerful that yeah. someone's running. And like, also, it's a common. So you can easily pick this
yeah,
up.
Especially in our play group, enchantments are the one thing that, for some reason, always stick around. Like, artifacts get dealt with, creatures get dealt with, but enchantments, yeah. it's just like nobody really runs enchantment removal
well, here's
in
the
our play group.
Yeah, here's the thing. I think it's pretty common in most play groups because you run a lot of creature destruction. Well, a lot of artifacts are creatures. So creature destruction already hits artifacts.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, artifact just feels better. There's more artifacts played. Like, I don't know what the percentages are. Let's just make up some numbers. But on average, I'd say 80% of the cards on the table that aren't lands are creatures.
Mm-hmm.
You know, 15% are artifacts, and the last 5 are enchantments. Well, mm-hmm. you're just not going to put a bunch of cards in your deck that deal with 5% of stuff.
Right.
But yeah. some, but there's
oh, some of them are so broken.
Oh, how many oh, times have you been at the table? Somebody's got an Abyss or
yep.
oh, just all kinds
Sylvan
of crap.
Sylvan Library, just, even just like silly things that yeah. help them out way more than you can help yourself out at that point.
Yeah. Worst case scenario, you blow away a Sylvan Library or something, and it's fine. Like, you know, you set your opponent back, you use the card, you know, and that's if you know that the Erase isn't going to take out a god or something.
Yeah. Now let's move on to blue. Blue in this set, not the most powerful color. Some really fun cards though, and I think this first one is definitely that. It's
I think there's some good EDH cards.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. The first is Clever Impersonator, which yeah. is 2/2 blue for 4 total. A creature shapeshifter. It's a clone effect. It says you may have Clever Impersonator enter the battlefield as a copy of any non-land permanent on the battlefield. So it can become an enchantment.
It can become a soul ring.
Can become a planeswalker.
Yeah. Oh my goodness.
It's awesome.
It's very clever.
It's awesome. It's going to go in most decks that have blue.
Yep.
It'll probably replace my clone in a lot of stuff.
It's like a better Phyrexian Metamorph in a lot of ways, because that can... That
it's
can
a way better.
Count, it doesn't count as an artifact. So
yeah, exactly.
It just counts it was as what it is.
Yep.
Does it still count as a creature? It's no, because it's a copy of it. So it,
yeah.
it's not a creature if it becomes a soul ring.
But it is yeah. when it's in your graveyard.
Yes.
And it's also low casting costs. Yeah. So
and it says any yeah. non-land permanent, so it gets around hexproof.
Oh,
it's definitely a powerful card.
Yeah, I could yeah. see this being like more fair as something you control, kind of like that crappy
yeah.
one that was
right.
the promo card.
Mercurio Pretender.
But yeah. this is nuts. Awesome.
Especially if you're running a monocolored deck and someone else has something in another color, which is like, of course you can't play that in red because it would be busted. Or of course you can't play that in blue, but whatever. And a clever person here pops in and you're like, Watch me get broken.
I can play it now.
Yeah, I'd love to just see. I can't wait for the stories about, like, yeah, this one person played this one card and it synergized perfectly with my deck because it wasn't supposed to.
Okay, so the next card, Keru Spell Snatcher.
Oh, yes.
It's 3 and a blue for a 3/3, but it has morph. The morph cost is 4 and 2 blue, so it's a high, hefty morph cost. But here's why. When Keru Spell Snatcher is turned face up, counter target spell. If that spell is countered in this way, exile it instead of putting it into its owner's graveyard. You may cast that card without paying its mana cost for as long as it remains exiled.
Right. Rules clarification, you can only cast it once, right, and then it becomes a regular spell being cast. It'll go to the graveyard after it dies, etc.
Now, right, other rule. So would you be able to cast it as an instant if it's a creature?
No, or does you it still have to obey the casting cost on card. Gotcha. You can play it. But if it's an instant, you play it as an instant. But if it's a creature, you can't play it with flash.
Correct.
Unless you had something that allows you to play creatures as... it's like it's in your hand, basically.
Yeah, Vedalken Orrery would be the... Yeah. I think it's non-creature cards, actually, for that. But,
I know one. Prophet of Krufix.
Oh, yes. Prophet.
We haven't talked about her yet.
Not to mention,
she was getting a little bit upset at us.
Yeah. I'm actually feeling... She's, like, glaring at me right now. And it's great because Keru Spell Snatcher works perfectly with Prophet of Krufix. Where are you going to get that 6 mana from? Prophet of Krufix.
Yeah. Plus, you're in blue. You're in the flicker colors. You're in... Oh, flicker doesn't do anything. But,
no, she's a transfer.
Animar, bounce them back to your hand. Play them again.
Play them again.
Steal the next spell that they cast. I mean, this is one of those cards like Glen Alendra, Perplexing Chimera. These type of cards have the ability to just lock the entire game out and stop your opponent from casting spells because you can steal everything.
Mm-hmm.
You can get in these situations where you're playing them, bouncing them back to your hand, playing them again face down, and poised and ready to steal the next spell. I mean, if you have Prophet and this, you've got mana every turn to do it. Now you just need a way to repeatedly bounce it back to your hand.
Yep.
That's easy to do. You're in blue. So all of a sudden, like, hey, I have the ability to steal your first spell everybody else's turn. I mean, you're going to win.
Yeah, that's really busted.
And unless they cast Wrath of God. No, because it counters it.
It counters
you don't
it.
Even have to.
As long as you have the mana up.
Oh, that's true. Because with Perplexing Chimera, if they played Wrath of God and you use Perplexing Chimera on it, you'd just
switch.
You'd be the controller spells, of Wrath of God. It wouldn't matter. It'd still go off and kill everything. But in this, it actually counters the spell and puts it off to the side.
Yeah.
And then you can choose to cast it, but you don't have to. So if you go, oh, I don't want that Wrath of God to happen, I'll take it and put it in exile. I just won't cast it.
That's really insane.
Yeah, this card is broken.
Yeah,
put it in your blue decks. Put it in Animar for sure.
Yeah. The last blue card we're going to talk about here is called Thousand Winds.
Wow, we didn't even practice that.
I know, right? We did it in sync.
Plus, our wind impersonation is really good.
We got 2 layers of it, too. We should start an ADR studio. For 4 and 2 blue, or 6 total, you get a 5/6 flying creature elemental that has morph for 5 and 2 blue. When Thousand Winds is turned face up, return all other tapped creatures to their owner's hands. All right, that's a blowout.
Yeah, that was really good.
I like this card a lot. I see it as a card that's like your second version of Cyclonic Rift in your deck.
Yeah.
And it's great in a deck like Rafik when
or
you're
evacuation.
Not, yeah, exactly.
Oh my god.
It's great in a card like Rafik where you're not really attacking with more than one guy, so your opponents are going to be the ones that have to deal with this. You can do it at instant speed because it doesn't use a stack. You can do it when someone's like, "All right, I swing out," and they're like, "Good, he doesn't have enough mana to like really blow me out, I hope." And you're like, "Nope, morph, woo, everyone goes away." It's great.
Yeah, these and blue's so control-y that like a lot of times you're just trying to buy for time until you can use your infinite combo or get 2 extra turns or whatever, and all of a sudden this is just like boom, everything back to everybody's hand. This can really screw people up too, because if they don't have a Reliquary Tower or something, they're like,
"Oh,
crap, I'm holding like 17 cards." And And I can only play 2 of them, and it's just like, it feels really bad.
Wait a second, because I just want to play devil's advocate here for a second, because it's only tapped creatures.
Right.
Correct.
So, like we were talking about earlier, tapping out against all your opponents
doesn't happen all the time.
So, I feel like this is a very high mana cost, something that you have to play it like face down for 3 first. And then its morph cost is actually more than its regular casting cost.
Right.
So, you know, you're essentially paying, what, 5, 6, 7. Eight, so 10.
Oh, 10 total,
10
yeah,
to,
yeah.
Like, if you cast it and then use it the same turn.
Oh, yeah, I don't think you're ever going to do that. You're going to have to put it face down.
Put it face down and
be
then
ready.
Wait for it.
Exactly. I mean, think about it against, like, a token deck. You know, there's always that point where you're pretty sure they're going to go off in a second, and, like, you've got to have an answer, and this can be an answer to that. There's also, like, Rafik type decks where it's like, ah, gosh, he's going to kill me next turn. I'm going to kill him the turn after that, but I just can't make it to that turn. Well, this guy will let you get there.
Yeah.
Like those type of things. It's like a Wrath effect. It's like you said, Cyclonic Rift. It's not as good. It's not as good, but I would play 10 Cyclonic Rifts if I could.
Yeah, right? Exactly. Right. So 1,000 wins gets you part of the way there.
Yeah, it gets you 60% of what Cyclonic Rift does, yeah, which and is
sometimes,
still awesome.
Sometimes you just need an incremental gain to be able to pull ahead in the parity race. You know, you're probably going to cast this right before it's your turn. You mm-hmm. know, when everyone's had their chance to swing out or whatever, like, because sometimes the table just gets aggressive for one turn, and yep. everyone's like, all right, guys, guess we're going to do it. Everyone starts swinging out, 1,000 wins. You are up top, because you can just do it at the beginning of your turn when you untap. You can essentially protect yourself from 1,000 wins.
And I guess what I was thinking is there's that white angel that essentially kills everything when she comes into play. She kills all tapped
creatures.
Sunblast
Angel, yeah.
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 And something like this that's better than her is she doesn't kill indestructible or, mm-hmm. you know, and this gets around Hexproof, it gets around Indestructible, yeah. it does get around a lot.
It's yeah. not your vigilant, dude.
It's not perfect, don't get me wrong, but right. I just think it's pretty strong. And also, like, it's a 5-6 flyer.
Yeah. yeah.
Like, sometimes they're just hitting you with something in the air, and you just need a flyer, and you just play it out.
Yep.
It doesn't have to Cyclonic Rift them every time.
Yeah.
That's the thing about Cyclonic Rift. If they got one creature on the table that's bashing you in the face, like, it just buys you one turn.
Yeah.
Yeah, so...
I mean, I can see this really just as it's like your fail safe switch. You're, yeah. You know, you hit it. It's like, oh, God, he's coming with me with everything. Whoosh. You yeah. know, it's better than, it's even better in a lot of ways than Cryptic Command, because Cryptic Command just taps
whoa,
them all down.
Whoa, whoa, slow down, dude.
Because this way, I mean, usually.
Pump those bricks.
Whoa, you know, hey, what about you know what? Incomp, you know.
You know what?
Do it all both. Together. Do them both.
Do both. Do Cryptic Command to tap them down and then. Throw them oh, back
there
in
you go.
Hand.
Throw them
that
up to the hand.
Combo.
For a
Wombo
solid
combo.
11 mana.
For only 6 blue.
It's Commander.
And 6 other.
It's yeah, Commander. It's Commander. Yeah.
I got 11 yeah. mana.
I'll
in my
make
back
it
pocket
there.
All the time.
All right, let's talk about some artifacts. First up, we got Ugin's Nexus, which is 5 mana for a legendary artifact. It does have some windy qualities.
We're not doing
to
that
it.
Anymore. We're not.
If a player would begin an extra turn, that player skips that turn instead. And if it would be put into a graveyard from the battlefield, instead exile it and take an extra turn after this one. So you get an extra turn if it gets tossed into your bin.
So if they try and destroy it, or if they do destroy it,
yeah.
then you get an extra turn. And while it's out, nobody can get extra turns.
Yeah, they have to skip
including yourself.
That's really strong.
I just feel like there's so much this week that's going to make my Shroom deck better. Like,
yeah.
you know, especially something like this, you can sack, you know, there's like a trading post or mm-hmm. something like that where you can sack, you know, an artifact. Now you draw a card and take an extra turn.
Yeah.
And
now
you can recur it.
Well, now you can
you
recur
though,
it with Shroom.
It gets exiled.
It gets exiled out.
Yeah. Ah.
See, that's when okay. they're like, oh, yeah, Craig wants to build that Shroom deck. We have to make sure that we... Okay, yeah, you just exile.
The thing about extra turns, though, is the things that give you extra turns, they end up taking quite a bit of mana.
Yeah.
So unless you can cheat the mana cost with Helava or something like that, yep. the extra turn actually becomes your turn because you paid 7 mana or 5
to
mana
turn,
to get
yeah.
the extra turn. What you can do now is you do the installment plan. So on this turn, I play Ugin's Nexus. And then on my next turn... Now I can use it, and I actually do get 2 turns because I get mm-hmm. my 6th turn and my 7th turn.
And without paying any mana for it, if you're able
right,
to sack
exactly.
it.
Able to sack
and
it.
What so, I'm more excited about this for in is more my standard deck because it's, again, playing a lot of artifacts.
Oh, that's
whatnot.
Right.
Shrapnel Blast.
Shrapnel Blast.
Blast.
Exactly.
It's pretty awesome.
Yeah,
also,
that's nice.
It gives extra turns to access to extra turns to colors that don't normally get
mm-hmm.
extra yeah. turns. You know, blue's the king of extra turns. You know, but if you're in green, you're not getting a lot of extra turns.
Yeah,
well,
exactly.
Now you can.
Yeah.
So a lot of times, if you just had 2 turns in a row, you would win because you're like, I can put this out, but it won't make it around the table before, you know, this other stuff happens. But if I can just take one extra turn, I can just win this whole game. And in only in blue can you get those extra turns. And blue's not usually the one that needs the extra turn to just win. I mean, sometimes. But things like red. Red needs that extra turn.
Yeah.
Or green. Green's a really good one because they just don't ever get it. And it's
yeah,
like,
exactly.
I'm going to put out a huge creature, and if I ever get to attack with it, I'll win.
Yeah.
But it'll just never, you know, there's 3 players that are going to try and kill it by the time it's my turn again. Well, Ugin's Nexus.
Yeah. I do think its first ability has a place in EDH, too.
Oh, yeah,
because a lot of the times, like, that, my God, that card that you played
yeah.
against us, what times?
Yeah.
Time Sifter, or, you know, like we were talking about earlier, if you cast, like, 6
time
extra
sieve.
Term.
Time Sieve, yeah.
Time Sieve, yep. And, you know, you, or you cast 6 extra terms, now it's, or, you know... What's that? Tidemaster or whatever. It's like now you have.
Yeah.
I'd like to use Time Sieve to sack Ugin's Nexus to begin another. And then the also nice thing is that even for blue here is like this is a very hard ability to counter. It's not a spell. It's an artifact that's getting put into the graveyard.
Yeah.
So unless you have a way to stop that from happening, it's like that turn's going to begin.
And once you put it into play, they don't want to destroy it. So
it benefits you too much.
By the way, if somebody puts this into play, destroy it right away. Don't let them save it until they actually are going to be able to kill you with it. Make them use it like right now when they're maybe not ready to use it. Yeah.
Yeah. Don't let them hold it over your head like I did with Cryptic Command that one time.
Famous stories. Yeah. Okay, let's move on to lands really quickly because we've already talked about it. Fetch lands. Fetch lands are awesome. That's all I have to say. They're going to be great for us because we have dual lands, old school dual lands, you know, that are available in the format. I'm not saying everybody has them, but, you know, and the shock lands.
As long
lands.
As the lands say, like, for instance, Bloodstained Mires, like, sacrifice it, pay one life, and you tap it, and you find a swamp or mountain, then you put it onto the battlefield, not tapped, and you get to shuffle your library. Yep. So if your card says it's a swamp mountain, you get to put that card into play.
Yep.
What I love about this is how close in proximity they printed it to the Return to Ravnica block. Yeah. So now we have... you know, people for new players, there are inexpensive shock lands and now inexpensive fetch lands. And, you know, like we've always talked about, mana fixing is so key. And
it's really a lot of times the difference between a really good deck and a pretty good deck
is the consistency you get from mana fixing. Yeah, absolutely.
Also, things with like landfall. You know, there's mechanics that deal with when lands come into play.
Mm-hmm. Or it's like Crucible of Worlds.
Yep. Yeah. Crucible of Worlds and fetch lands are awesome.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's going to open up a lot of strategies people didn't have access to because they couldn't afford the fetch lands. So, yeah, it's really good.
Yeah, that's why we think this set is going to be open so much is people will be getting these fetch lands.
Actually, the lands in this set are so great for EDH.
Oh, yeah.
Because the wedge lands, so those are the three color lands for each clan. Mm-hmm. And then there's the life lands. So they come into play tapped, but you gain a life when they come in. And they,
same with the wedge lands, too.
Yeah. And they tap for, the wedge lands come into play tapped, but you don't gain life. And the wedge lands are basically like the gates, the guild gates, except for that you gain one life. And they're just for the enemy colors, right? Mm-hmm. No, they're just for the allied colors.
Allied, yeah.
Yeah, because the fetch lands are for enemy. So anyway, here we are. There's three different types of lands for the tap for different colors. Mm-hmm. Just so good for EDH. Like, you just need your deck to have as many ways to tap for different kinds of mana as possible.
And they have the artifacts that do it as well. So basically, thank you, Wizards, for doing this. It means a lot to
us. This is maybe the best thing about the set for EDH players. It's just access to a lot of mana fixing.
Yeah, I can imagine people were excited, too, when Shards of Alara came out because for the same reason, if they were playing Commander back then. Were they?
Who knows?
Let's talk about multicolored cards. And this is, I think, the heart and soul of this set are the multicolored clan cards of all the tribes and stuff.
Let's talk about the charms first.
Sure.
Charms historically really powerful because versatility is so powerful. We've talked about them before. We're not going to go through all of them because a couple of them are not that great, but let's talk about the Abzan charm. So it's white, black, and a green. For an instant, it says choose one. Exile target creature with power 3 or greater. Second choice, you draw 2 cards and you lose 2 life. Third choice, distribute 2 1/1 counters among 1 or 2 target creatures. So... again, versatility, really good. The ability to exile a creature at instant speed, we've talked about it before, really
very
powerful.
Yeah.
This only costs 3 mana, so it does get around something like Gaddic Teague, which we talked about last week. Then, if that's not available to you or that's not attractive to you, you can just draw 2 cards and pay 2 life, which is in Commander the
blood,
2 life. Yeah, exactly. And the last one, I think, is just... It's the worst... of the three to distribute 2/1/1 counters. So it's basically like a Feral Invocation kind of.
Yeah, I think this is a great pauper card as well. I mean, obviously there are better options to exile, like Path to Exile and stuff, but it's not easily accessible.
But
to
that
everyone.
One can't draw you cards if you're looking around the table and
exactly.
there's nothing
to exile. The different stuff you can do with this is really handy because it makes it so much more useful in different parts of the game.
Yeah, and I think when you look at this card, you know, in the way that we always do is how many phases of the turn, when is this... you know, usable.
Yeah, the quadrant theory. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. The, you know, during their turn, if they're attacking you, you know, you can get rid of something. Or if you just see their Ulamog or their, you know, what's the infect guy?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, 3 or greater, sorry.
Exile. Yeah. So you can get rid of something that's indestructible.
Did I say it kills Gaddic Teague? It does not.
No, but it gets around casting
Gaddic
costs.
Yeah. Which it definitely does.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you draw 2 cards. Let's say you just need cards, which in these colors, typically... it's tough. Green and white are a little bit tough.
Black's going to be your draw.
Yeah, black is going to be your draw. But something like this, draw 2 cards for 2 is at instant speed is good. And then if you need, you know, an extra 2 mana to or two plus one plus ones to deal something to something else, or, you know, this is also the color, these are the color schemes where the plus one counters
infect,
do extra stuff. Yeah. Oh, the infect. Oh, I love this for infect.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
Well, again, because in an infect deck, you may have things that do, that make your creatures, like, they're more efficient at making creatures bigger, but they don't also do these other things. So it's like, yeah, in an infect deck, this is a great top deck. Because if you don't need to kill something with power three or greater, then you just draw two more cards, and then, you know, hopefully those cards are awesome because you've built your deck right. You know, and then if you're close to killing somebody, then it can give you the two plus one counters to just finish somebody off, especially in infect, where it's like, I can do eight poison, but if I just need anything that adds a couple more, boom. Yeah. Or even like something like Rafik, where it's like, well, I'm going to get double strike. So this is actually putting four damage on something, which, you know, if
which it's you wouldn't be able to play this in Rafik, but you could play it Gave or something like that. So now in Gave,
colors.
You know, you're in Gave, typically you're playing like doubling season or something like that. So now it's four plus one plus one counters on. Just, would that be only two creatures? Yeah, it's still only on two creatures. Yeah. But
moving on, the other charms I don't think are that great. We were talking a little bit about them a little bit before the podcast. I think the biggest one is Sultai Charm, which is black, green, and blue, and you get to choose one: A, destroy monocolored target monocolored creature; B, destroy target artifact or enchantment; or C, draw two cards and then discard a card.
This one's awesome.
Each one of these is important.
Yeah, this one's awesome. Just the ability to destroy a creature, artifact, or enchantment with one card. Yeah. I mean, just that, I'm sold.
Right, absolutely. For three mana, having the option is amazing.
Yeah. And then in an instant where none of that's viable for you, you can at least draw two cards and discard one. So
right, it's a better loot. You get to get two in your hands.
And in the commanders that use these colors, like, you know, Damia or Mimeoplasm, those kind of feed off of the graveyard. So the one that goes into the graveyard can
actually
be advantageous.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good point. Really good point. I think this is the best of the charms for EDH anyway.
Yeah. Oh, also just for you guys that are looking at these commanders as we're talking about them, it's important to note that the color order is different. So in this case, Mimeoplasm is not. So Sultai Charm is black, green, blue, but on the card, Mimeoplasm, it actually goes green, blue, black. So just make sure.
Oh, just the way they've laid out the symbols?
Yeah, the symbol is different.
But it doesn't. Yeah, okay.
Right. Because, like, black, green, blue is technically bug, but in this case, it would be bagoo the way that they've written it.
Jimmy, you're observant. I never even would have noticed.
Yeah.
Well, I don't even know what order they're in now. I'm looking at it. I'm like, I don't even know what order. It's blue, red, white. I don't know.
Well, it's based on how the wedges, I think, are made. If you look at the back of the card, we talked about that in the Gavin episode. How
I think they just randomly put them on there. What are you talking about? They don't think about it.
Yeah. Are there any other charms we want to talk about?
Yeah,
I think you guys should just look at the charms. I think they're really, really good. Teamer charm might be the only other one I think that is as worth potentially putting in a deck with the colors.
And typically with the charms, they've made them so that they know which generals have these colors right now.
Yeah.
And I think they've made them to be able to fit into each one.
Yeah. All right. So let's talk about the ascendancy enchantments. There's again
each
one
clan
for
has
each
an
clan.
Enchantment. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, okay. Abzan Ascendancy, white, black, and green for an enchantment. When Abzan Ascendancy enters the battlefield, put a 1/1 counter on each creature you control. Whenever a non-token creature you control dies, put a 1/1 spirit token creature with flying onto the battlefield.
Wow.
This is like my favorite ever.
It's interesting because you'd think for with the first part, which is put a 1/1 counter on everything, you want that in token decks.
Oh, yeah.
But then the second part says when a non-token creature you control dies, make a 1/1 flying token. So it's good. Both sides are good. It's hard to take advantage of both.
I think,
for good reason. Good design.
This is definitely going in Gave, which is, you know, obviously something that could play it. One of the only token decks that could play it. And something like this in Gave, typically your way of generating tokens is non-token creatures.
Mm-hmm.
So something like this, and you also, typically in my deck, I'm not running that many flying creatures.
Mm-hmm.
And flying creatures in tokens can be very, very powerful because now you have doubling season, parallel lives, primal vigor. So you're doubling your tokens every time. Now you're creating, you know, let's say four birds or, you know, two flying spirits. But now you also have your pump spells.
Mm-hmm.
You have your, you know, Guy's Anthem, your, you know.
Your mass pump.
Exactly.
Yeah, mass pump. Yeah.
And, I don't know. That can I think this will be powerful.
I think there's ways to use it. I think I think it's a little bit difficult because the two halves are sort of split, but it is two powerful effects.
Yeah.
So.
Let's talk about Jeskai Ascendancy, blue, red, white. Whenever you cast a non-creature spell, creatures you control get +1/+1 until end of turn. Untap those creatures. whenever you cast a non-creature spell, you may draw a card. If you do, discard a card. So there have already been multiple infinite combos in Standard and Modern that have been made with this card, because untapping all those creatures is nuts. It's a very powerful effect, and being able to do it by casting a non-creature spell is
very important.
There are
whole cards that just say untap all your creatures.
Yeah, absolutely.
So this one actually says whenever you play another card that does something else, you just happen to untap all your creatures.
Yeah. I'm afraid of five-color decks that can use all of these cards.
Just yeah, because so you utility. Can actually break them, because I think, yeah, there's that, and that's one of the ways too, right, is to play this Jeskai Ascendancy in with green in a five-color deck or something. But it's just super powerful. Yeah.
And it gets there.
Yeah, and it just lets you loot every time that you play a non-creature spell. You know, it's just going to smooth out the whole game for you. You're not going to draw too many lands if you don't want to land, or you're going to find lands if you need them. I just think this card's really powerful.
Yeah, it's got utility all over the place. Plus great art, straight up Avatar The Last Airbender status. Like, look at that guy. That guy looks like Aang in the middle. He's straight up.
I can't think of that without thinking of M. Night Shyamalan now, and it just makes me sad. Yeah.
That does make everyone sad.
All right, the next card is Mardu Ascendancy. It's a red, white, and a black for an enchantment, of course. Whenever a non-token creature you control attacks, put a 1/1 red goblin creature token onto the battlefield, tapped and attacking. And you can sacrifice Mardu Ascendancy, the enchantment, to make creatures you control get +0/+3 until end of turn. Really interesting that it gives them toughness and not power. You'd think it would give them power, right?
Yeah, it gives them, it's like kind of like raising the banner, giving them a little more resistance. You know, this is fun. I think it's better in a limited format.
Yeah, it's one of the weaker ascendancies, I would say. But
And I wish that it was something in the air that was, you know, like a 1/1 flying creature or something like that. But obviously,
it would be broken in limited.
Well,
I'm thinking in Kalia, something like this, where you don't want her to die. So you play this, you're typically attacking with flying creatures. So now I guess you have some on the ground too, like whatever. But it's sac ability to give +0/+3 might be more interesting there, because now you can save Kalia if they're like,
Yeah. It's just, I don't think it's super powerful. Just making 1/1 guy on the ground in EDH is just too slow to do much.
It's a nuisance.
Yeah.
It's a nuisance card.
It's barely a nuisance.
Yeah. Let's talk about Temur Ascendancy. It's a green, blue, red, Animar colors. Creatures you control have haste. Very nice. Whenever a creature with power 4 or greater enters the battlefield under control, you may draw a card. This is definitely a card I'm playing in Animar. You want card draw. This gets you in, and guaranteed almost everything you play outside of your like Farhaven Elves and stuff is going to get you a card.
And so, the haste is totally relevant.
Yeah, because you're playing the card and you get to attack with that card that you are also drawing a card off of. And if you're playing Animar, you may just draw another free creature to play, and you could just continue this cycle and start pumping dudes out.
Well, and in Animar, you're going to have huge stuff because you're reducing casting costs. So you just might draw Ulamog, play him, and attack with him because he's got haste.
Yep.
Or you put out your Rattleclaw for 2, for 3, you flop it for 2, cast your Temur Ascendancy, now it has haste. You tap it for 1.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You do all kinds of stuff. Haste is one of those things that you rarely want to play a card that just gives haste, but you often want to play a card that does something else and gives haste.
Yeah.
So that's a great reason. I think this card, especially green, wants haste very often because you're going to play some huge creature.
Haste and trample.
Yeah, but it just doesn't have the ability to survive until you can actually use it a lot of times. Well, if you can use it right away, it's got a lot more chance to do something for you.
Yeah, definitely.
The last ascendancy is Sultai Ascendancy. It's black, green, and blue. It says, at the beginning of your upkeep, look at the top 2 cards of your library. Put any number of them into your graveyard and the rest back on top in any order. So it's kind of...
It's a little deck fixing.
Yeah, isn't this Jace's first ability, Jace the Living Guild Pact?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, so it's basically like a free loot scry. I don't even know what to call it. But the thing is, these colors, they have green and black in them. They want things in the graveyard. Oftentimes, they want things in the graveyard more than they want them in their library. So this can be, and it also does things like smooth out your draws, let you find land, or if you already have land, let you get rid of land. You know, and you can choose the things that you want to put in the graveyard, like stuff with flashback, or stuff that you
that's
want to
the
reanimate,
difference between
or
that
all
and
kinds
Jace.
Of stuff.
Or if you're running a lot of stuff with Delve,
Delve.
Which typically you're not going to.
Yeah, Jace's ability is different, and this makes Sultai Ascendancy a little better, that Jace has to put a card into the graveyard.
Oh,
so Sultai, you can choose 2 or 1 or 0, and Jace, you always have to do 1.
Gotcha.
So it does give you a little bit of flexibility. The thing is, if you're playing green, I'd rather play like Sylvan Library. You know,
depending on what you're doing. I mean,
Sylvan
so
Library
this,
won't let you.
Sylvan Library is always awesome.
It's awesome, yeah, but it doesn't actually let you right. cycle through your deck quite as quickly because right. after you've done it once, then you're actually only looking at
one
unless you
card
pay
each
the
turn.
Life.
Yeah, exactly.
And something like this specifically, I see this as a Mimeoplasm card. I see this as yeah. a definite if you have a Mimeoplasm deck because now you can yep. not only stack up your graveyard, but you know also fix your library at the same time.
Yeah, yeah. You. I mean, obviously, you want to get both ends of it. You want the. The deck the card selection of being able to choose what's on top of your deck and what's not, but you also want a deck that wants things in the graveyard and can use the stuff in its graveyard.
Which yeah. I think by the end of this block, we'll see a lot more stuff in these wedge colors that are really digging out of the graveyard.
Yeah. Okay, so the next card we wanted to talk about is called Crackling Doom. It's red, white, and black. That's Mardu colors. It's an instant. Crackling Doom deals 2 damage to each opponent. Each opponent sacrifices a creature with the greatest power among creatures he or she controls. This card's great.
It's just bonkers. I mean, it's an instant. Are yep. you like seriously yeah. on top of every all yep. of that? They also made it an instant and 3 mana cost.
Yeah, and it's the greatest power too. So many cards are just like everyone sacrifices a creature. Token decks are like meh. Sucker. Yeah. This is like oh
nope.
Crap.
You're getting
sacrifice
rid of
your
big
biggest
thing.
Dude.
Yeah. Yep.
Just I don't care if it's indestructible. If it's hexproof.
I do care if it's hooded gone. Hydra though. Don't.
And I like how they thought, like, that's not powerful enough. What else can we do? Well, let's just have everybody take 2 damage also.
Yeah, right.
right.
Let's just stick it to them a little bit more. Now, this
just
card's
little,
really good.
Just yeah. a little on top of that, yeah. Yeah, I think it speaks for itself. It's just a great card. It can be played at instant speed, so you could wait for someone to... You're like, oh, that person's going to play an Ulamog next turn. Ulamog gets played Crackling Doom.
Like, this card may be more fair if it did it to everybody. Including
yourself.
Yourself,
right, but it doesn't. That's right. A good point. It's a very good point. I like the card a lot. Yeah. If you play the colors, run it. What are you doing? Oh my gosh. Kalia, bring Crackling Doom in. The next card is...
Ooh, this one actually scares me.
Yeah, the art for it is nasty too. I believe it's Zergal Helm Smasher's hand coming in, punching the Narset. Yeah, it's Deflecting Palm for a red and 1 white. It's an instant. The next time a source of your choice would deal damage to you this turn, prevent that damage. If damage is prevented this way, Deflecting Palm deals that much damage to the source's controller. Wow.
This can be crazy because there's a lot of decks that just try and kill you all in one hit with yeah. one thing.
Voltron Commanders.
Yeah.
Infect.
Yeah.
This is
it won't do the
mana.
Infect damage because the Deflecting Palm actually does the
right.
damage. But
that's right.
It'll still like do the damage. I mean, think of something like Rafik, whose goal is to like hit you with a double strike 20/20.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So it's only gonna do the first 20 damage, but yeah. it's still gonna be like a huge chunk. It might kill them.
Mm-hmm. And I like what this does is it doesn't make Rafik deal that damage to you.
Right.
The palm does the damage to you. So it takes away the you know the general damage and yeah. whatnot. Right.
But it's still very powerful just
oh, absolutely.
Because the nature of EDH is like oftentimes one huge,
one thing.
Yeah, if one haymaker is just going to drop you. Yeah. And, if you yep. can, yeah.
and if it's a turn before yours, you play Deflecting Palm and it's like, that's all I needed because you just tapped out because you thought you could kill me.
Yeah. Also, sometimes it'll just kill them. They think they're going to kill you and the yeah. damage deflects back into their face and they're just dead. Yeah. Like yep. if they're at 20 and they attack you with Rafik, they're dead.
Yeah.
Like.
Right, because this counts for first strike and yeah. second strike because it's, so it's that like, source doing damage. Yeah, yeah. I should also mention that it doesn't actually work with Infect because it deals damage in the form
oh, true.
Of -1/-1 counters or poison right. counters.
So you just prevent the damage?
You prevent it, yeah, because it's not dealing that damage. So great card.
And it's only 2 mana.
2 mana, yeah.
So it's easy to leave up. If you play this, you're going to feel really safe when you have that in your hand. It's going to be hard
absolutely.
To kill
yeah,
you
exactly.
in one turn. Yeah,
yeah.
The next card is... Dune Blast.
Oh yes, so we talked about this with Marshall yeah. as well.
All these like board wipes, yeah. it's great.
And the art is so great.
Yeah, this is cool.
So it's four colorless, 1 white, black, and green. It's a sorcery. It says choose up to 1 creature. Destroy the rest.
Dun, dun, dun.
Destroy the rest.
Yeah, just a great fun card. It's not my favorite board wipe, but those colors.
It can be a one-sided board wipe though.
Yeah,
it can
definitely.
Be like, oh, I'll keep my general and I'll destroy everything else. Like, and then I'm going to have
yeah.
Jaleva on the table.
Especially
and
if your general,
nothing else
yeah.
out there.
Or if you're like, you know, Sigarda and you're going to kill someone in one turn because yeah. of this card.
That's,
obviously, these colors don't work with Sigarda, but just saying it works like that. It's
anytime
nice.
You can, like, destroy everything, but you still have something.
Yeah.
is very powerful.
Yeah. I mean, now you have a one creature advantage, which can attack, can do whatever, or can stay up.
And
as
oftentimes
a
that one creature can be something crazy broken.
Ulamog.
Yeah. So
now they can't sacrifice any of their regular creature permanents. They have to be ditching their lands or artifacts.
If you have Ulamog out, you don't need Dune Blast, though. You're probably going to win.
It's true. It's I think this card does fall under Win More, but it also can definitely, I mean, like any board wipes, erase parity and put you just ahead, and if, especially if you're losing. Like, that's great. This card has that ability.
I think Win More is actually important, too. We talked about it. Oh, so, yeah. Very. You need finishers.
The thing that I do see about this is 7 mana cost with 3 different colors. Mm-hmm. It's going to be tough to play.
Well, the fact that it's 7 mana cost covers up that 3 color thing, though, because you're never going to be
able to be way later in the game.
Yeah,
right?
And if you're playing those 3 colors and you're at 7 7 mana and you don't have all your colors, then you've done something wrong. Put more fetch lands in.
Yeah, take these lands from this set and put them in.
The next card is Flying Crane Technique 3, and then blue, red, white, or red, white, and blue. Instant, untap all creatures you control. They gain flying and double strike until end of turn.
Now, they don't have to be tapped.
That's right.
That's the thing about this card. Token deck, these aren't necessarily in token colors, but red, white is. And actually, blue has been coming around as a token color with Master of Waves, Chasm Skulker. There's some
Talrand.
So in recent sets, they've really started to push blue more towards the tokeny things. So all of a sudden, like, if you've got tokens and you give them all flying and double strike, like, you don't need 100 tokens. You need 20.
Yeah.
Not even that. Like, I love this. This is probably my favorite battle trick of all time. Mm-hmm. But what I don't like about this is the wedge that they put it in. Because for me,
you want green and black in there somewhere. Yeah, right?
Exactly.
Because with Infects, it would be totally like a joke.
Oh, absolutely. Ridiculously broken. But so let's take this for a second. And what generals can play this? There's Zedru, who is typically like trading, you know, I'm going to trade you this, whatever. This doesn't really work that well. But with Ruhan, this might work. Other than that, I don't see many generals that would be taking advantage of this other than 5-color generals, in which case I see better cards out there.
Mm-hmm. I just think you can start to play a token strategy with these colors now.
Yeah, I think it'd be really fun.
Yeah, so what can happen is this and tokens is just like, it's just like another sort of, I don't know, Overwhelm or Sanctified Charge type effect.
Yeah,
you
definitely.
Know, where it like doubles up the amount of power you've got on the board. Which, you know, when you're playing tokens is a lot. And it gives them all flying so they can get through where maybe they wouldn't have been able to. Because if you've got 20 tokens, you might not be able to kill somebody.
Right.
And I guess with this new general that they introduced for these colors, Narsai, that this could definitely be a keeper in that deck.
Narset.
Yes.
You can play it for free.
Yeah, exactly.
Because you can play it for free.
Yeah.
I want to build a deck around Narset, but we'll get to her in a little bit. Let's finish off our multicolored cards.
Okay, so we've got Sorin.
Solemn Visitor.
Why is he so solemn?
Because he's visiting a land of dragons. He's like, I belong in a land of vampires.
Well, no, it's a land of no more dragons.
No more dragons, yeah. And
maybe that's why he's solemn. He's like, man, I wish there was dragons. You know what would be cool?
So
if there was dragons.
Yeah, he's standing in front of like the broken...
Then
like,
he'd be Sorin, super stoked visitor.
Yeah.
Sorin, dragon rider.
James Bianca, write that down.
Oh my gosh.
I'm
going to...
Please submit that as
I'm
going to
Photoshop
name.
Sunglasses on him and like a little beach hat.
Super
like he's like
visitor.
Ready to suntan with some dragons.
Put a margarita in his hand. All right, Sorin, Solemn Visitor. He's 2, a white and a black, 4 total for a 4 loyalty planeswalker. His +1 is until your next turn, so not until end of turn. Hmm. Creatures you control get +1/+0 and gain lifelink. His -2 is put a 2/2 black vampire creature token with flying onto the battlefield. And his -6, you get an emblem with at the beginning of each opponent's upkeep, that player sacrifices a creature.
Right.
So the ultimate's pretty strong. It's not you just win, but it's pretty good. Make a 2/2 flying vampire token. It's just not high enough impact for EDH. Until your next turn, all your stuff gets lifelink. It's okay.
It's cool. I mean, I like that it's until your next turn. I don't think we've seen that wording very often. So it has extra value. But overall, I don't really see this as the strongest of the Planeswalkers. You know, he's no Garrick. Apex Predator. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. Even though Garrett costs 7 and this guy only costs 4.
It's just hard to see which of those, besides the ultimate, which is strong, it's just you're going to have to get there.
Yeah.
With the first two abilities, it's just hard to see how that's going to add up to having any real effect.
Yeah. And a lot of decks, to be honest, wouldn't mind sacrificing that creature.
Yeah.
So. See this guy going in like a agave token deck. And especially his ultimate, what I do like about that is that it's kind of like a Shieldred that they can't get rid of.
Mm-hmm. Right.
With the, you know, with the emblem, so...
He starts at 4, so it's not the most ridiculous thing to get him there.
Thing is, in EDH, if you're close to getting ultimate, everyone attacks you. So it's almost that ultimate better do something pretty serious because you're gonna basically put a target on you, a really big target as soon as you get close to an
ultimate. Exactly, which is why I think he's super niche. But I think in something like Gave, where I am playing doubling season because it does have that green as well.
Yeah, then you just put him out ultimate.
Then you just put him out ultimate. Yeah. Now it's...
Yeah, absolutely.
I like this next one.
Yeah, next card
is awesome.
Utter End with Zergal Helm Smasher at the helm. Huh, I get it?
At the helm getting smashed?
Yeah, it's 2 colorless and a white and a black. Instant, exile, target, non-land, permanent.
Instant, exile, target, non-land, permanent.
That covers a lot of bases.
If you're playing white and black, this is going in your EDH deck.
Oh my gosh, yeah. I'm immediately putting this in over so many other different removal spells that aren't half as good as this in like my Kalia deck.
It's actually better than, is it Terminate?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, for EDH players. I think in other formats, the one mana matters. In our format, it does not. And since it's an instant totally matters like a lot.
Yeah.
This card is awesome.
It just targets anything you want, really. And it's exiling it. They don't have a chance of getting it back. It's instant speed.
The fact that it's exile, the fact that it's instant speed, and it's anything you want, it's great. I mean, the only thing you could wish for is that it did
land. As well.
Yeah, so it's like Vindicate, but I think it's
better. At instant speed, though, because Vindicate's a sorcery.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm saying. And
very
hard
to get.
And Vindicate costs 1 less, but that doesn't matter to us in EDH. So.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome. I mean... It'd be better if it hit a land, too. I think that is occasionally like relevant. Like, they got a Maze of Ith or something.
Mm-hmm. I do not think I'll take out my Vindicates from my decks to put in Utter End. I will probably take out my Swords to Plowshares or probably more likely my Path to Exile because I don't want to give them the extra land.
Interesting. Mm. And the last card besides the legendary cards is called Villainous Wealth. It is black, green, and blue, and X. It's a sorcery. Target opponent exiles the top X cards of his or her library. You may cast any number of non-land cards with converted mana cost X or less from among them without paying their mana cost. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
I mean...
Get some extra mana because of the green and then cast this sucker. You are playing a lot of cards.
Let's say you could cast it for... You have black, green, blue, and 7. So you have 10 mana total. Totally very common in EDH. That's actually pretty modest. You could exile 7 cards and cast any of them that are 7 or less, which is probably going to be most of the cards.
Could you imagine if you got like a Gilded Lotus in there?
Like, oh my God. I mean, everything. Like, so I have a friend that plays a Damia deck that's just basically ramp, ramp, ramp. Get Damia out, draw 7 cards, yada, yada, plays huge spells. Something like this. Now not only are they going through their own library.
They're going through yours.
But they're going through yours.
Oh, it's going to piss me off when somebody does that to me.
It's because it can cast any number of them. So if they have if everything's just like 2 costed or 3 costed, it's like, great, I get all of them. It's like,
that's if it's modest. If it's, this is EDH, we're not very often modest. Yeah. A lot of times you're doing something like, I'll create 20 mana and I'll exile the top 20 cards of your library and I'll cast...
All your favorite things.
Everything, because there's no card in Magic that costs more than 20 mana, so I'll just cast, 17 cards right now. A lot of times, if you can get to about that amount of mana and you cast Villainous Wealth, you probably win.
Yeah.
It probably just says I win, because you can't...
I really think if you're playing all 3 of these colors, you should be playing this card.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome. Yeah.
Right.
If nothing else, to piss off the other player.
Yeah, right.
It's plus you played their cards. Those cards don't exist for them anymore. Yeah. Unless, I guess, if
it's like bribery,
they steal them back.
Yeah, it's like bribery where you get to play their enchantments and their artifacts. You get things out of your own colors.
Sometimes it could be cheaper though, like Control Magic and Ulamog.
Yeah, exactly.
If you don't want it to exist in the game, you can just not play it and leave it in exile.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's like they have no ability to guild grid it or recur it. I mean. Yeah. It's a good card.
Yeah.
Play that card.
I like it a lot.
I didn't even think about that. If you don't want to play it, you just leave it out.
Yeah,
that's the ultimate awesome. FU is you do yeah. it and you're like, you know what, this Ulamog,
I don't actually want it
because I didn't cast it from my hand.
I just exile your entire deck and I don't take any of them.
Amazing. So let's talk about the legendary creatures, the leaders of each clan. There's five of them total and they are all legendary creatures, which means they are all possible commander options. But I don't think you're going to want all of them as commanders. But let's just talk about them from top to bottom. So we're going to start with Anafenza the Foremost, who is your favorite color, is Craig?
Not the three most.
Not the three most. It should be because
she's three colors.
She's three colors.
She has a four power and toughness, though.
Yeah. She's the foremost.
She's not the four least.
She's black, white, and green for a 4/4. So vanilla test, great, and super cheap, which is always important for commander. Whenever Anafenza the Foremost attacks, put a +1/+1 counter on another target tapped creature you control. And if a creature card will be put into an opponent's graveyard from anywhere, exile it instead.
I like how she just randomly hoses like reanimator strategy.
Yeah, right?
Right?
She cuts them up on her like
and
chariot.
She's in the reanimator colors, but it doesn't do it for you.
Right.
It
does it for anyone else.
So it's only opponents.
I honestly think that I would put this in Caridor only for her second ability.
Right.
I do not see that first ability becoming something substantial.
Yeah.
Would you build a deck around her?
No.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Think you would
I just don't think either ability is powerful enough on its own. It's like if you put a 1/1 counter on all your dudes.
Sure.
The only reason would be if you're running a mill strategy, which you're not in those colors.
Yeah. Like, yeah. The second ability is nice. It's as though you're seeing an enchantment that does that, kind of like a rest in peace kind of card that just makes sure that people can't mess around with their graveyard. So not too much to say about Anafenza.
I mean, you do want to play some graveyard hate, but she doesn't actually just cover our graveyard hate because she doesn't do anything against instant sorceries, artifacts. Yeah. She's only creatures in your graveyard. So even then, it's like, I don't even know if I'd play her as graveyard
I think
hate.
She's much better as an addition to a deck. Like in Caridor, I see this as a definite, you know, probably over Grave Pact because now Caridor, I can recast this because it's a creature and it also is huge graveyard hate for all of my opponents. So if they're discounting cards or sacking.
But it only
creatures,
does anything for creatures. I mean, like I said, if they're reusing instances of sorceries or artifacts or enchantments, like it doesn't do anything. It's just creature cards only. I mean, that's good. Don't get me wrong, but it's not. It's not pure graveyard.
Yeah, you're right. It's not everything.
Yeah. So
Anafenza the four least.
It's fine. She's a 4/4 for three. the foremost. The three least.
Yeah. Anafenza the 4/4 for three.
I will say though, typically in Caridor or whatever, I am making them sack their creatures. I would like to. I'm probably going to play around with this.
Yeah, it's not useless. I'm just.
Yeah.
I just think so.
No, you're right. That it's only creatures, so it's far less effective. Yeah.
Okay, this next one's pretty powerful, though.
Yeah, I want to build a deck around this.
Enlightened Master. She's 3 and Jeskai. See what I did there?
Nice.
Yeah, that's blue, red, white. She's a legendary creature, human monk, 3/2. She has first strike and hexproof.
Hexproof is so important. Just that word alone that makes this card great.
And then she says, whenever Narset attacks, exile the top 4 cards of your library. Until end of turn, you may cast non-creature cards exiled with Narset this turn without paying their mana cost.
Yep.
We talked about her a little bit before, but yeah, she's kind of like in the vein of Helleva. Yeah. Except for it's only your library, it's the top 4 cards, and it's any non-creature card. So,
right.
Listen, we've said many times, and this is always going to be true, if you can cheat the mana cost of stuff, you can break it.
Omniscience.
You can abuse it.
You can play everything for free.
Yeah. It's just the type of effect that's like finding a loophole in the normal rules of magic. And that's the way you can just pull stuff off that the game wasn't designed to allow you to pull off. Like, cast like 20 mana worth of spells in one turn. You know, that's what she allows you to do.
And the colors she's in, too. Keep in mind, you can also play lands.
Yeah.
You can play artifacts, enchantments. You can play, take extra turn spells.
No, you have to cast it, so you can't play a land.
Oh, that's right. Okay. You may
but
cast.
But still, to your point, these colors are the colors where these instants and sorceries and non-creature spells are.
Like, being able to blast out and take an extra 2 turns just because she attacks.
Like you said, omniscience.
Omniscience, anything, and this is like, it shares two of the colors with Helleva, and so you can definitely stack the top of your deck. I think I'm going to convert my Helleva deck to a Narset deck.
I think
deck,
I am
to
too. Like,
the only thing I would say is she's 6 mana.
Yeah, she's expensive.
Helleva's only 4. She doesn't have flying,
right?
So they can just block her. She may just die. I mean, she has hexproof. That's great, but doesn't matter. If they've got a 4/4 out, she's dead. So you need to get her unblockable, whereas Helleva flies.
Yeah. Narset is hexproof, so that gives her, like I'd say, an extra 2 mana casting. You know,
But the thing is, if she dies once, she now costs 8. Yes. That's the thing. If they kill Helva once, she's still cost six. So they're going to have to kill her at least twice to put her into, like, it's hard to cast her range.
Yeah.
Narset dies one time and she's going to be difficult to cast for a little while.
Yeah.
But that being said, with Narset, you can get, you know, let's say average two spells, possibly three, possibly four, instead of guaranteed only one.
Yeah, true. Yeah, she's great. I'm just saying there is downside.
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't know if she's some sort of evasion.
You know, I feel like her. You might want to build her as a Voltron deck. You know, something.
Oh, I think you definitely do because you want to stack her with all those effects. Like,
yeah,
she's already got hexproof, but you want haste and you want unblockable.
And not to mention, you're going to put in the cards that make her Voltron, like an enchantment aura that makes her infinitely better.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm just thinking now, like, you can go, you can do planeswalkers like Tezzeret. You can do instants like, you know, search up an artifact, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
pretty cool. And you can play Jace and Brainstorm to make sure the top of your deck is nice and stacked up.
Yeah.
All right, next up we got Sidisi, Brood Tyrant. She's the Sultai clan leader. For one, a... one in Sultai, which is black, green, blue. Whenever Sidisi enters the battlefield or attacks, put the top three cards of your library into your graveyard. Whenever one or more creature cards are put into your graveyard from your library, put a 2/2 black zombie creature token onto the battlefield. I'm not too hot on this one.
I think you can build a deck
around me for sure.
Because it's whenever one or more creature cards are put into your graveyard, so it's each instant where they are. But if you play three cards and they each do it separately, then you would get to trigger it three or four times. I mean,
yeah.
I think you could build your deck where she could be pretty broken.
Yeah, I think there's definitely possibilities here for that.
Yeah,
for sure.
I think just like the Abzan one, I don't know if I'd build necessarily a deck around her, but I would definitely put her in
Mimeoplasm.
Mimeoplasm.
Yeah, exactly. Just because there are, you want to have things in your graveyard for Mimeoplasm to interact with,
and plus having tokens and for only four mana.
Yeah,
makes sense.
She's definitely.
I think
good...
you could put her as your general in a bunch of self mill type stuff, and you could just be making like. You could probably get some crazy combos. I don't know any off the top of my head where you're getting like 10 2/2s out in turn, and then you're just recycling your graveyard and just, you know.
And those are typically.
And you could maybe do that really early. She only costs four, so maybe you could do that by turn 5 or 6 and just.
And especially two of those colors, the green and the blue. I mean, like Wonder.
They mill,
you know, well, those creatures that when they're in your graveyard do extra stuff too. I always think of those.
Black
when
too.
Think
Black
of
really loves
up
the graveyard. So.
Right.
Yeah. I remember I used to play this deck back in the day that there was a lot of arguments about whether it was legal, and what you'd do is you would draw your 7 cards, then you wouldn't play a land, and you'd draw your 8th card, and then you'd purposely discard like a something big, usually like a Crawworm, and then you'd on your second turn you play your first land, on your third turn you play your second, then you animate dead the Crawworm and have a turn 3 Crawworm or whatever huge creature you wanted. Yeah, so that the reanimate strategy has been around since beta, and it's still pretty good.
All right. Next up, Zurgo Helm Smasher.
Zurgo Helm Smasher. He's Mardu, which is red, white, and black, and 2 colorless. Legendary creature, Orc Warrior. He's a 7/2. He has haste. Zurgo Helm Smasher attacks each combat if able. He also has indestructible as long as it's your turn. Whenever a creature dealt damage by Zurgo Helm Smasher this turn dies, put a 1/1 counter on Zurgo Helm Smasher, which creatures are going to die because they're going to probably block him, and he's indestructible.
He's a 7/2. Yeah, you're going to want to block him. More limited than anything else, though. So this is why I'm kind of not so hot on this guy either.
I think you can build an aggro deck with him, though.
Yeah, I think so, too.
I think so, too.
And he's sort of like the icing on the top when you get him out in turn, you know, 4 or 5.
He's extremely vulnerable with a 2 toughness and the indestructible only during your turn.
Right.
But that being said, like... you know, nobody's really running like lightning bolts in EDH.
No, they're running Path to Exile or something. So you got to give him hexproof anyway.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think he's any more vulnerable than a general that has 5 toughness.
Right.
You know, because most of the stuff that's going to kill a 5 toughness is going to kill a 2 toughness also.
Yep.
So it's all about getting hexproof on it. And the fact that he has indestructible during your turn is just a little bit better. If you're playing an aggro strategy, then he's great. He could be your general. Yeah. But if you're not, then he's probably not that useful.
Yeah. All right, finally, the last one, and I'm so glad I get to read this one because I'm so putting him in my Animar deck. It's Serac Dragonclaw. He's teamer, so it's red, blue, and green, and 2 colorless for a 6/6. So anyway, that's 5 for 6/6. He's a flash. Flash, Serac Dragonclaw can't be countered. Creature spells you control can't be countered. What? And other creatures you control have trample. He's like literally
you brought your
everything.
Crew with you. They just sound a lot like you.
Yeah. Jimmy's doo-wop band.
Yeah, that's right. He does everything you want in an Animar deck. He can't be countered, and which means that you also get the ability that creature spells you control can't be countered. In a creature-heavy deck, this is already amazing. Mm-hmm. And other creatures you control have trample, which is what you always want in a deck with tons of huge dudes. So he's really just straight up.
Yeah, trample is evasion.
Yeah, and he's wearing a bear for his like chest
piece.
Well,
he punched it in the face.
Yeah, because he's a badass.
That's right. Both his rank and his scars were earned in single combat against a cave bear. What a dude. I like that connotes that everyone he has, all other creatures have trample, and they can't be countered because he beat a bear in the face and punched it in half.
Right. If you did that,
half
Jimmy,
of his
you wouldn't
face
be able
on
to be
either
countered,
shoulder.
And yeah, you would have trample.
I would have trample.
I'm going to go find me a bear.
I like Sir Dragon Claw. I like this guy because you can play him in your Animar deck, or you can just play him as your general. I think it's you could totally build around me, Commander. Get him out in turn 5. He's already 6/6. You could probably Voltron him up. Other creatures you have can't be countered. Mm-hmm. I mean, what a powerful ability.
Mm-hmm.
It's crazy. Especially the fact that he has flash. You could play him on somebody else's turn.
Yeah.
Well, plus you play something, they try and counter it. You flash him in. Oh. Counter it effectively counters their counter.
Yeah,
so they're going to be scared to counter your stuff anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Anything that gives all of your creatures like a couple of abilities, which he does, is going to be pretty strong. Yeah. I think he's got uses for sure.
Well, that is the wrap-up then of all of the cards that we see in Khans of Tarkir that we think would be good additions or not so good additions for EDH. Let us know in the comments below on rocketjump.com if you guys have any recommendations for what you think we missed. I know for sure that you guys might be looking at Dragon Throne of Tarkir, but I'll let you guys check that one out yourselves. It's kind of like Critter Hoof Behemoth on a stick, which is great. But yeah, I think the set's great. I'm looking super forward to it, to draft it, and to supplement all my commander decks.
Oh yeah, there's so many cards. I'm already like, oh, this is gonna go in this deck, this is gonna go in that deck.
I don't think I've ever seen a set that has so many cards that I can put in different decks.
Me neither. I've been waiting for these wedges for like 4 years.
Just the lands alone are like every fetch land's going in every deck that has the colors that it needs, and then you know all the wedge lands that didn't exist before. So if you ever had, you know, Riku or one a commander like that, now you've got a wedge land for it.
Definitely.
It's just great.
What I find most awesome and most upsetting for my pockets about this deck is it got me into standard. It's going to get me into modern, and it's going and I'm going to draft the hell out of it, and I'm going to want some cards for my EDH decks.
Better pre-order a couple cases there, Craig.
Jeez.
Yeah, Craig. And let me open some of the booster packs just because I really want to. I've been looking forward to it.
As long as
packs.
I can smell them, I'm cool, man.
It's true. It really does make a big difference.
This just sounded wrong.
it's cardboard. That's how you get played off stage.
As long as I get a sniff,
zone.
Jim.
You get a nice 1,000 win playoff. You tap
it's
yourself
like,
out with a bad joke,
like four
and you're
wins.
Gone.
It's like 3.5 wins.
Yeah, it's actually just one win. It's just called Josh's win. Just get out of here. Craig, thank you so much for coming on, man.
Oh, thanks for having me.
I hope you have a winful exit from this podcast. Also, as a reminder, you guys, we do put up weekly videos, so you can actually watch these podcasts and see the cards come up on screen, the ones that we're talking about that we don't tell the card information for. And it's got nice moving graphics. It's very easy on the eyes. And I think it's just it's another great way to experience the podcast if you are in front of a computer and not in your car, for example, and you
want. Yeah, if you can, I'd say that it's a lot easier to watch it that way.
Absolutely.
Because, yeah, even the cards that we actually explain all the mechanics, we still put those cards up on screen. So it's just a lot easier to be like looking at the card while we're talking about mm-hmm. it.
Not to mention you get to see the sweet art and you do get a more complete experience. Not that the podcast isn't one. We obviously try to focus on making the podcast the number one priority, but we put a lot of work into these videos. They are spent hours on them, painstakingly editing them all together. So we'd appreciate the views too. And I think you guys would like it.
I have to say, every time I've listened to the podcast, which has been everyone, I always watch the video, and I have found myself every time needing to do other stuff but just watching the cards. I'm like, oh, that art is so beautiful.
Oh yeah, the art. Even when we're talking about not a card, just maybe a philosophy or a strategy or something.
There's always something going on.
Card art up. Yeah, and the card art is just so amazing.
Yep.
Yeah, it's great. And actually, we've been working on ways. Oh, I don't want to spoil it, but we're going to improve that.
Sweet.
Very
it's
soon.
Look sweet.
It's
gonna,
I think we're always working on ways to improve the experience.
Yeah, I think our episode with Teaching Magic is one of the better examples too, because all the philosophies we talk about, it's written out in text, so you can definitely see it there too. So make sure you guys check it out. It's all at rocketjump.com. You can find us under the podcast section.
Oh, and also big shout out to our sister podcast. They're only in their second week here. It's called The Masters of Modern, and it's hosted by Alex Kessler and Glenn Jones, and they talk about the modern format. If you have not checked that out, you should definitely give it a listen. Modern is actually... Modern's a lot closer to EDH than you might think.
It's absolutely. A lot more cards are opened up for them to play.
Yeah, and the brewing opportunities are very large. And, you know, if you're thinking into getting into something a little bit more
now
competitive.
Now is the time.
Now is the time. Fetchlands are here.
Fetchlands, dual land, or shock lands, all of them.
It's much more cost effective as well than standard because nothing's rotating really.
Right. Yeah, from a long-term perspective, I would say that Modern is a lot more palatable than something like standard.
Yeah.
So definitely check out that podcast. Also on Rocket Jump, you can find it on the main page. You can find links.
And those guys know about Magic, I think, a lot more than we do. Not that we don't, but they definitely have a deep understanding of it. So
they're definitely like competitive Magic. You know, if you're interested in that at all, they have that mindset, and it's very
improving your game.
Yeah, learning, it'll improve your game, your EDH game, just to listen to them talk about competitive Magic. Yeah. So all right, everybody, thanks for listening. I just have one last thing to say.
Yeah. See you guys at the Khans of Tarkir pre-release and sealed and draft events. Go to your local game stores.
Thank you for your attention. For further inquiries, send an email to commandcast@rocketjump.com or ask us on Twitter at JF Wong and at Josh Lee Kwai. See you later, alligator.
Greetings, humans.